out here at beautiful Colonial Fort Worth, Texas, my former home, Fort Worth, Texas.
That's right.
You know, my brother moved back here. He lives here now. He's a Fort Worth guy. And this is where my parents moved after they left Mississippi. They packed up the wagon, the covered wagon.
Got the horses together.
Got the horses together and then came out here right after they got married. Like right after the ceremony, they moved out here to Fort Worth so my dad could go to seminary out here at Southwestern.
Wow.
So this is where the Keith family began.
It's where the dream began.
It's where the dream began, and I think it's sweet that Colonial put up that big plaque up there on their side of their clubhouse and said, this is where the Keith family began.
I think it says Charles Schwab.
Oh, is that what it says?
Yeah.
I'm not wearing my glasses, so yeah. I must have misread that.
Yeah.
But speaking of Colonial, how many times have you guys played this course?
Oh, gosh. Well, we haven't played the new course that they've renovated, but... Man, I bet I've played it 30 times.
I probably played it 10 times.
Really?
Yeah.
I've played it 0 times.
It's so much fun to play.
So awesome. Yeah.
Why is it fun to play?
Partly because the tournament is here, and so you've watched the tournament all these years.
Playing the same holes that the pros are playing.
There's been so many moments out here, but it's an old course, too. It's
beautiful.
It's got old trees, you know. Some of these trees are... 150 years old, the tower, the fairways, and it's just a great challenge, too. 3, 4, and 5, even before the remodel, were three of the toughest holes I've ever played. And I think 5's even more ridiculous now, because now you can, as the Trinity River is down on your right, now you can see it.
Mm-hmm.
It used to be kind of a hidden problem for you over there, but now you can see it, and they've made the hazard much more in play on the left side. It's awesome.
Did there used to be like a Hogan's tree or an Eisenhower's tree or something that
right here on 18, and lightning took it out.
Like about when? 15 years ago?
Yeah.
It's been a while.
Yeah, 10 or 15 probably.
Okay, and which one was it? Was it Hogan's tree or Eisenhower's tree? Why am I thinking Eisenhower?
That's at Augusta.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But you're right. It was named after somebody, but it wasn't Hogan. It was somebody's tree, though.
Which was by...
George S. Patton's tree?
We'll use that as a holder.
Not to be confused with this body of water, which is Crampton's Lake.
That's Crampton's Lake? I thought that was Mark Holt's Lake.
No, that's by the old ballpark.
Oh.
Was Crampton dumped 2 in there? In the water?
I think so.
To lose the Colonial?
Peter Crampton did that? Greatest live album ever.
Yep. Crampton Comes Alive.
did that golfer ever release an album called Crampton Comes Alive?
No.
No, it didn't.
So it looks like it was 2017 that the tree came down here on 18 after a storm.
And it was a very historic tree, very big,
very dairy,
old growth,
had,
very dairy Daracet.
Oh, it was known as Miller's tree because I hit it every time I hit my drive on 18.
Man, I used to hit that thing all the time, too.
So it didn't have the name of the tree? Why did we think the tree was named?
You did.
Craig Miller.
I know, but he kind of thought it was, too.
I always thought it was.
I swear it had like
Big Tree on 18.
No, it wasn't Big Tree on 18. Yay, Fuller Peak, or no? It was somebody's name. And it was somebody famous, like McConaughey's tree or something.
Okay, I don't think so. I don't think so.
So what are the chances, since I don't get over
Zero.
Here to Fort Worth all that often, that they could work me in today and let me be part
like
of the tournament
Zero.
And do, you know.
You can't just work your way in to a PGA event.
It's not like a doctor's office where they have work-in appointments.
They could work you in, since we know the tournament director.
Right.
They could work you in, not as a player, but they could work you in, I'm sure, as a volunteer if you wanted to work a hole.
Score?
No. I don't want to volunteer for anything in my life.
Well, that's the truth.
I want to play.
You could barely get him to work.
And I don't understand why they can't do a work-in. If doctor's offices can do it, I don't even understand the work-in appointment at the doctor's office.
Well, it never works.
They have to.
It always works for me.
Really?
Yeah.
Never work me in. We'll see you next Tuesday.
They always. It's not like standby, to where you may get on, you may not. I swear, I always get the work in.
Because you never set appointments.
Right. I always show up in a panic. That's what the receptionist says. Boy, you always just show up in a panic.
I know.
You don't plan ahead.
I know. It's just really bad.
Can he see me? Because it really looks infected.
Yeah.
Gross. Yeah.
Anyway, so it's good to be out here at Colonial. I look forward to playing today. Have you guys been noticing the moon?
No.
Okay.
Too many clouds.
We'll now move on.
What's going on with the moon?
Destroyed your show.
Is it still up there?
My mic sound weird or hollow or anything?
You're fine.
No.
Okay. All right. Just checking. It's the last full moon of the spring, and it's a flower moon. The moon is lit up in vibrant orange and red because the sun and the moon are directly opposite of each other in the sky. And it's called a flower moon.
Okay.
Now, the Cree people, Northern Canada, they know it as the, this says F-Frog Moon, but I'm assuming that's a typo and they put a space in frog. It's not F-Frog.
Yeah.
But the Dakota and Lakota people of the Great Plains call it the Planting Moon. Marking the time for spring planting. So it's beautiful, and the shots I'm looking at it from
all over the world
look very beautiful. So enjoy the
flower. Let me see some of those.
While we have it. Okay, look at this.
Why don't you share?
Look at that.
Oh, isn't that beautiful? Huh. Wow, that's great.
So beautiful.
Cool. Wonderful. So
that's one of the best things we've ever had.
It is.
It's sunshine.
No, EA, it's not sunshine. I guess technically it is in a way.
On the moon, yeah.
So you're somewhat correct there. Also, the Graceland thing was stopped. They stopped the mosque at Ground Zero that was happening at Graceland.
Man, I got sent so much stuff on that. So was it a hoax?
The FBI has opened up an investigation on it. So it's looking like it wasn't a hoax. It looked like
someone did try to defraud them somehow.
It's possible attempted fraud.
Okay.
They're investigating it right now. Now, this is based on the fact that, or the allegation that Lisa Marie took out a loan from someplace, and she used Graceland as collateral, and then she died, didn't pay back the loan, and now those people that, gave her the loan were going to foreclose on Graceland, and it was supposed to be sold on the courthouse steps yesterday. Jeez. But a judge issued an injunction because Elvis's granddaughter, Riley Keough, filed a lawsuit saying that this is fraud. This is BS. She's the one who, I guess, owns Graceland now after her mom died.
She's the one taking care of business?
Yeah, she's TCB right now with a lightning bolt. So now the FBI is investigating. So it appears there's something to what Riley is saying, that this is fraud and that someone was trying to steal Graceland from her.
Well, that's good. That would have been terrible.
You would have loved it.
No, I wouldn't have.
You have been praying for that thing to be dismantled and put in boxes for years.
I don't pray for anything to be dismantled.
You think that you've described Graceland as a holy waste of time.
No, I just thought it was more of a comedy shop, but I don't want it to be torn down.
Okay, it's not a comedy shop. It is the King of Rock and Roll's domain. This is where he sat in there and got all his great ideas for songs he didn't write.
The one thing we didn't talk about the other day, Junior, and this is kind of genius, long before HD TV and having more than one TV in your house, he had three console TVs right next to each other.
Mounted into the wall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he could watch all three networks at once.
Yes. Another example of an innovator.
I think he nailed them into the wall.
No, he didn't nail them into the wall. They were very tastefully put in there.
Me, I always heard back in the day, that day, that they had that set up at the White House, too, so the president could watch all three newscasts.
Got the idea from Elvis.
Maybe.
When Elvis was meeting with Nixon.
Just nail it to the wall over there, man.
You just get some hammer nails and then nail a console TV up
2x4 underneath
and everything. Let me ask you something, President Nixon. Do you like my cape?
I do.
You don't think that looked like the picture of someone who had kind of gone off his rocker a little bit? Elvis posing next to Nixon holding up a badge while wearing a flowing blue cape.
And that's when I started laughing, when I saw that. How could
it
you not laugh
fashion.
When you see that?
It was fashion.
A guy in a cape, so delusional.
He wasn't
sweating
delusional.
From his upper lip. And
well, lots of people sweat from their
face as he's holding up
upper lip.
Spare metal that
Nixon
gave
sweated
him.
From his upper lip a
they
lot.
Both did.
But Nixon didn't wear a cape. You know why? Because not all heroes wear capes.
Batman did.
Yes, yeah, so anyway, they at least stopped the mosque at Graceland.
Graceland Zero.
Graceland Zero. I don't know if... Okay, in case you're tuning in, I need to explain. I'm not making some negative comment about Islam. It's a reference to an old song on the YouTube when they were talking about building a mosque like three blocks away from Ground Zero, and some guy was so pissed at this, he made a really horrible song that sound way too happy and triumphant, especially during the lines when he's singing, "Thousands of Americans died in the attack." It's way too major of a key
of
to sing those lyrics.
All the songs we made fun of, that is the worst.
See if you can find that, Tyler. I'm sure you're... already frantically
no
searching
way,
for
there's
it.
That still in.
Oh yeah, we've got to stop the mosque at Ground Zero.
I thought you always played it.
No, well, I mean, I did, but it's on YouTube. I would just play it from YouTube.
Oh, okay.
Here's the only picture of Elvis and Nixon. That just looks like a big coat. I don't think he's wearing a cape.
Okay, well, maybe I was remembering it wrong. No, he's wearing it. That's a cape, isn't it? Back
Is
there?
It?
Is it not?
I don't think so. Because there are a couple of other angles. Like,
okay, well.
It is kind of crazy looking, though. Isn't
like
it?
There, see, it's just a big coat.
Oh, okay. Hey, President Nixon, I just want to come up here to. And, you know, he flew there in the middle of the night to get, like, a badge from Nixon. Because he got obsessed with law enforcement, and he wanted to be a part of all law enforcement teams. And because he was Elvis, these organizations would,
that.
Okay, we'll give you an honorary badge.
Yeah,
and,
look, they made him a special agent.
Yeah, yeah, see there?
U.S.
Special Agent Elvis Presley. And, yeah, so it's a little crazy looking.
Yeah, it is.
Look how zoned out Elvis is.
I know. He was pretty loaded up when he went up there and met with Nixon to discuss. And he went up there because he had, like, great ideas for Nixon to... I think he was wanting to stop. The thing is, he wanted to stop all these hippies taking illegal drugs was what he, ironically, was talking to Nixon about.
Hippies, man.
And he just won. Hippies, man. Apparently, he just won some title bout.
No,
look
that's
at
his
that
actual
belt
buckle.
Belt
he just
buckle.
Had an oversized belt buckle. Yeah. But, yeah, went up to meet with Nixon in the Oval Office.
Hey, President, we got to stop the mosque at Ground Zero, man.
We've got freedom of religion. I understand, but Ground Zero is one location where a mosque shouldn't stand.
We gotta stop the mosque at Ground Zero.
Oh, yeah.
Coming in snow, every victim and hero. Thousands of Americans died in the
sad, sad day.
That day,
sad, sad day.
Oh, yeah.
I designate Burlington the War Memorial.
Can't let them build it. No, 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 no. There's a painful memory in our minds. Memory in our minds. Our hearts keep breaking when we envision that tragic time.
So there's a sample of Elvis's last tune, We Gotta Stop the Mosque at Ground Zero. The one that he went up and hand delivered a CD to President Nixon.
I just tweeted
burned on it.
I just tweeted that picture for those who want to play along at home.
It's a great picture. Uh-huh. It inspires a lot of confidence in America when I see Nixon and Elvis.
It's America at its craziest, maybe. Where the president would take time to meet with Elvis Presley
in the middle of the night.
A fake badge.
Yeah. Well, I don't know that it was a fake badge. It's a real badge. It just doesn't have any
But it
authority.
Had no power with it. Yeah.
Right.
And then at the end of the meeting, Elvis is like, man, is the White House kitchen still open? I want some peanut butter and banana sandwiches, man.
Double nano.
You know the sandwiches that have that stuff on it.
Yeah.
All right, the kind that have the stuff on
okay.
it.
Okay.
Thank you. That is the ODEC.
Thank you, Craig, and welcome to Fort Worth.
Thank you.
You have nothing
there.
To do with the city.
Yes, I do.
This is his birthplace.
This is my hometown, man.
Yeah.
From here.
What do you do for Fort Worth?
Where the West begins. Or is that St. Louis? Which one? St. Louis is the gateway to
here.
The West.
Yes. Yeah, it kind of begins
Washington.
Here. Yeah.
But yet, this is where the West begins, but we didn't put the gateway here.
Right.
Which I'm not sure why. If this is where the West begins, we wouldn't have the gate here.
This really is where the West begins because just topographically, when you go west of Fort Worth, everything gets
a
lot
changes.
More barren, and
Hello?
And you go east, and it gets, you know, into East Texas and the woods and the trees, and it really is the start of the West.
Did the word topographic change pronunciation in our lifetime?
I don't think so.
Like, I hear topographic, but yeah. I always used to say topography and topographic back when we were in school and stuff.
Topographic?
Yeah.
I don't think I ever said that.
Yeah. And
but
topography.
I may be saying it wrong.
Topography. Well, you may be saying it right, though, too.
I guess that's a possibility.
Yeah. Things change. Heck, I was watching an interview with someone, and she said several times hyperbole. And I'm like,
huh.
And I think now there's more of a movement to, well, no pronunciation is wrong. You know, meanings of words change, pronunciations of words change. Let's not get prescriptive on things. Let's live and let live. So will hyperbole become a new pronunciation of hyperbole?
Maybe.
Will frown become a new pronunciation for friend?
I think it already has.
Gaylord Perry pioneered.
Friend.
The late Gaylord Perry.
Who, yes.
Passed away due to his ticket stock appearance. The Justice Department has filed a lawsuit against Ticketmaster and Live Nation. So this lawsuit could potentially lead to the breakup of Live Nation Entertainment, which is the company that came out of the 2010 merger between Ticketmaster and Live Nation. I have to confess, I have not followed the whole...
It's really confusing.
Mm-hmm.
I get why everyone hates Ticketmaster, because it's like, well, they sell us tickets, and tickets are expensive. But I have no idea if Ticketmaster is overcharging for these fees, or whether they're being charged fees by the concert venue and all that. Like, I bet you there's more moving parts than just, hey... This is who we hate, man. We hate corporation. We need corporation go away.
Yeah, there's a lot of complaining about that, and
but maybe they are doing something wrong. I don't know. I just haven't done this deep dive.
I think you
into
have mad
issue.
Customers based on price more than anything.
Yeah, there's a similar thing happening in the world of short-term rental with Airbnb and Vrbo.
Mm-hmm.
They're the same company, I believe. And the fees they charge are extraordinary. You will book an apartment for $250 for a night. And then when you go to checkout, your grand total is $650.
Good
because
Lord.
Of cleaning fees and taxes and mysterious service fees.
I know.
I don't know how they're getting away with that.
I guess I don't even understand why service fee... became a thing.
Yeah.
I thought that's what I'm paying your company to begin with for, is the service of this whole deal.
Right. Yeah.
You don't then add a service fee to your service. That was what the original price was for.
It's well, like no, hotels. That's for the apartment. Oh. Then we got to service the apartment. Then you have to pay
Louise.
For the service.
Just can we make things all inclusive? Like, just price it for real. Mm-hmm. Or do people get ticked off by that? Because we like the psychological trick of having the lower price that we can anchor and sell to our spouse.
Hey,
this
only
is only
200.
So-and-so. And then, but yet we complain about it on the other end of it.
Let's start
our
own company.
We're just going to complain no matter what, I guess.
Let's start our own company, Yo For Real. And you,
that it gives
just
you
one basic
for real
price,
prices.
And there's no service fee.
And it's then someone, believe me, someone will come in and complain. And when you give them the bill and they go, well, but there's tax on here. Yeah, but that's in addition. I mean,
that's
our price
real.
Is all inclusive, but we still have to charge you tax for the. But yeah, but you said it was all included, that this was going to be the total price.
Yo, for real.
And then we'll just go back to the previous model. Because we'll soon start to realize that people's goal in life is to not be satisfied with what you're
anything.
Doing. Right. We have taken complaining to a performance degree. Everybody's a pro at it. But anyway, I have no idea about this lawsuit, but the DOJ has found enough in it that they say that they need to file a lawsuit against Ticketmaster. So we'll see how that shakes out. I'm trying to think of last time I bought a concert ticket for something. Seems like I'm always buying secondhand. I'm always buying pre-used concert tickets.
Or begging for them.
Yeah.
That's usually how it goes.
That's what I meant. Did I word it weird? The average ticket price from the top 100 tours in 2023 was
the average ticket price of the top 100 tours.
I'm going to say $300.
That's what I was going to guess. So I'll go
$299. $122.84.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
So that sounds pretty good to me.
Yeah. That's a bargain.
I'm so used to these. Because I only, I guess, go to the biggest acts, well, the ones who make me sit in a stadium for a while. I just can't stand concerts, to be quite honest with you. So it takes a really big one, and so the big ones, of course, charge the most money.
I just messed up on my Price is Right bidding. He went 300.
Mm-hmm.
Why didn't I go a dollar? Why did I go $2.99?
Where you could miss it.
So I had to hit it exactly.
Mm-hmm.
That was one of the dumbest bids that I've ever given you.
What is quiet vacationing?
Stay at home? Staycation?
Millennials are quiet vacationing rather than asking for PTO. PTO. Paid time off. Paid days off. We had this discussion a few months ago about companies offering unlimited PTO. And we were exposed to the idea that it's kind of a bait and switch. Like, it sounds good, but they actually have done studies and found that people use less PTO when they have unlimited PTO versus when you give them a set amount of PTO.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is interesting.
Yeah, you're banking on the employee wanting to do right by his coworkers and all that.
Well, you're also dealing with the psychological principle of use it or lose it. So if you have 15 days, let's say, of PTO and it's set, then you have it has a fixed number and you want to exhaust it. Whereas if it's unlimited,
gotcha.
You're not compelled to exhaust it because it's unlimited, and you end up not taking as much.
Yeah.
That's like, it reminds me of right out of college when I moved to Colorado with a buddy of mine, and we moved up there to ride our bikes and to ski all the time. And do you know how many times we went skiing? One time. Because every day we woke up and said, well, it'll be there tomorrow.
If it's always an option, oftentimes you don't take that option.
Yeah.
But if you're going up there, you're like, well, how often are we in this place? We've got to ski while we're here.
Right.
So millennials are doing what they call these workarounds, these quiet vacations to play hooky. Nearly 4 in 10 of millennials say they take time off without communicating it to their manager.
I'm just glad to hear millennials are actually working. That's good news for all of us.
God, yell at clouds.
I can't even remember which one millennials are.
I don't know either.
There's one of them that's double
that's
named,
kids.
Right? Is Gen Y the same as Alpha Z, or is Z millennial the same as non-boomer? Which one's Gen X?
I think Gen Y is also millennial, and then the most recent is Gen Z, but I'm not 100%
But Gen Z is different than Gen Alpha, right?
I think so.
Okay. All right. God, why we got to name generations, and then we got to talk about how they all are different, and then they hate each other. This generation hates that one for this one, and then this one hates that one for that one. It just doesn't seem to be designed to bring people together to me, to emphasize our commonality.
No. No.
Okay, so here
that's
it is.
That's what's fun is us fighting. I get it.
The Silent Generation.
Okay, 19, wait a second. Which one's that one?
1928 to 1945. That's when you were born.
Okay, those are boomers.
Boomers are 46 to 64.
Okay, those are boomers too.
Gen X, 65 to 1980 birth dates.
That's also okay, Dave. Boomer.
Then millennials or Gen Y, born 81 to 96.
Now they're getting called boomers.
Then Gen Z, born 97 to 2012. And the most recent, born 2013 to today, Alpha.
Okay. There we go. And which one's in the catbird seat? Which one tells all the other ones they're stupid?
I guess Alpha now.
Okay, so
they're Alpha's starting
in
to tell us all
seat.
What yeah. to do. Yeah.
Yeah, so this is what millennials are doing, which is the same as Gen Y. They say that they move their mouse to show they're still active on their company's messaging platforms,
see
like
what
Slack
I mean?
Or Microsoft.
See what
teams.
I mean?
Every generation's done this.
Yeah,
well,
yeah. Right.
Let's pretend just they're bad for doing this when they're not really working. And they've scheduled messages to send outside of regular hours, giving the impression they're really working overtime. It's greatness. So, yeah, there's a lot of workaround culture going on right now. Let's see. We'll do skip that. One Tesla owner is complaining, saying that his car's self-driving technology failed to detect a moving train, and he had a crash as a result of that. He said, and of course, since he's the only one in the car, he's responsible for it. And he says, look, I was the only one in the car, so, yes, it's my fault. It had to be, by definition, if you got to point to a human. He said, but I feel it was more the damn car that didn't recognize the train. He said, yes, you do get complacent, depending and thinking that the car knows what it's doing.
Yeah.
So you get a little complacent, thinking you've turned over this to full self-driving. That's what the driving mode is called. Full self-driving, which is another one of those things where you call it that. But then you want to get onto the guy for saying, "Well, you should have been paying attention and driving." You're like, "Well, it's full self driving." Yeah, but it doesn't mean full self driving.
I've got a couple buddies with Teslas, and they say that Tesla is very adamant about you still have to monitor the full self driving.
Right.
Because it's not there yet.
Right. It's a, and I wish. Has Elon at least tapped the brakes on every few months saying, yeah, it'll be next Friday at 12. We'll have full self-driving then. It's happening.
Not really.
I don't know.
In fact, he's been teasing this big August announcement, and it's supposed to have something to do with self-driving. Yeah.
Uh-oh. I was hoping he was distracted enough by culture wars to not be making false claims about self-driving. Four colors to avoid this summer if you want to not get bitten by mosquitoes.
Black.
They did a study.
Blue.
Dark blue.
And at the University of Washington, and they found that mosquitoes are attracted to. Black is correct, Giorgio.
I said that.
White.
Giorgio mentioned black, and that is correct.
Invisible muser.
That black, if you wear black, as Giorgio said, you will get bitten by a mosquito. I should know because I wear black all the time. Hmm. Now, Craig, you guessed something that was incorrect, and I can't remember what it was. But the other colors are red.
Okay.
Orange. And cayenne.
Like,
is that red?
Maroon?
This is what I don't get. Cyan. Is it cyan or cayenne? How do you say it?
Cayenne, like the pepper?
It's not spelled the same, because cayenne has an E and two N's and then another E at the end, right?
How's this spelled?
Or is that the Porsche Cayenne?
How is this one spelled?
Yeah, I wish we knew.
C-Y-A-N.
Huh.
And it's a color between, like, blue and green.
Yeah. It's like aqua.
Yeah. But what's weird about it is that, hey, it's Gracie's old friend.
Hey, what's up, Tommy?
It's Tommy.
How are you?
Tommy.
Former Ticket employee who, I think, ran down an old lady. Or
one,
did.
One of my favorite, favorite stories in Ticket history.
You can tell it's not Tommy's favorite story just by the look on his face. He's
already ready to get out of here.
He's already waving goodbye.
All right, good to see you,
the great, the great Tommy. Okay, so what were we talking about? Oh, mosquitoes. Yeah, it's a little weird that they give you the four colors, and it's red, orange, black, and cayenne.
Yeah.
It's very specific. But they found that mosquitoes ignored green, purple, blue, and white. So those are the best colors
green, purple,
to wear.
Blue, and white.
Okay,
green,
good to
purple,
know.
Blue, and white. So there all you right. go. The more you know. Y'all have a clock in front of me. I don't
know. Yeah, birthday.
Start. Okay.
Birthdays. Tommy Chong is 86.
Ticket Tone?
I think that was the other one, right?
Oh, okay.
Cheech Marin.
That's right. Cheech Marin hung up on us.
That Giorgio pissed off.
You made him hang up on us.
He hung up. Tommy Chong is the one. Do you guys get constant ads for Tommy Chong chewables, edibles?
Yep.
He's 86. Bob Dylan is 83. Robert Zimmerman himself. 83. I think that's his real name. I don't know. Is that his real name or is it Engelbert Humperdinck or something?
Something.
Gary Berghoff, 81.
Radar O'Reilly.
Mm-hmm. Patti LaBelle is 80.
Oversinger.
Is she?
Yeah.
Wow. Way to reduce her career.
But happy birthday.
Priscilla Presley is 79. Hmm. Would
and?
You? Would you?
What?
At 79... Would you at least plant your flag just to say that you had been to the moon, too? The same moon that Elvis walked.
Can you go easy on her? She just recently lost her daughter and her husband.
And that is most indeed. And her husband passed away like 78 years ago. And it wasn't her husband even at the time. They were already divorced.
Just go easy on her birthday.
But nice beaver.
Pardon me?
I'm also a fan.
You remember that line from Naked Gun?
Yeah, that's right.
When she was climbing the ladder up above Leslie Nielsen, and he said, "Hey, nice beaver." And she handed it down to him. She said, "Thanks, I just had it stuffed," and it was a mounted beaver carcass.
Great movie.
So many cheap jokes in that movie.
You think that's cheap?
Let's just rename it Cheap Joke.
I don't know. Kristen Scott Thomas, the actor from The English Patient, 64. John C. Riley is 59.
Greatness.
From Step Brothers, among other things. And Walking Tall, Walk Tall, or whatever the...
Walk Hard.
Walk Hard. That, the country music one, when he was the country music
guy. I'm
supposed to watch that.
Yeah, you should watch it.
Okay.
Carl Payne, 55, from The Cosby Show, and some spare show called Martin.
Attempted to draw Donnie offsides.
Rich Robinson, 55, guitarist from the Black Crows. Joe Dumars, 61.
Greatness, Hall of Famer.
Yep, Naismith Hoff. Pat Verbeek, 60.
Stars great.
What a ball greatness. Of hate, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Bartolo Colon is 51.
Cologne.
Tracy McGrady, 45.
T-Mac.
Yes, T-Mac. You're up to date.
All right, that's Muse, 735 on the ticket. Coming up next here from Colonial Friday Morning Scatter Shooting.
And now it's time for Friday Morning Scatter Shooting with your old pal, Junior Miller, right here on Sports Radio 96.7 and 1310, The Ticket.
And it's brought to us by Twin Peaks. Scatter shooting while wondering whatever happened to Yao Ming.
Yao? Yeah, where is he these days?
I don't know.
Is he the big Chinese basketball player?
Yep, 7'6", played for the Rockets.
Yeah.
Here we are at Colonial Country Club in Fort Worth for the Charles Schwab Challenge. Walking these 18 holes during this tournament has always been my favorite walk in Texas. So beautiful, so many great memories. With this being the 78th year of the tournament at this course, that makes it the longest-running PGA Tour event at the same course. That is quite a badge of honor. Mm-hmm. Ben Hogan is far and away the greatest champ here, which is why it's called Hogan's Alley. He won this tournament 5 times, and nobody else has won it more than twice. But the honor roll is stacked with legendary names like Jack Nicklaus, Sam Snead, Arnold Palmer, Lee Trevino, Tom Watson, and Phil Mickelson, just to name a few. It's been a great week for Luka Doncic. The fantastic fourth quarter performance in Game 1 on Wednesday night, and earlier that day he was named first-team All-NBA for the fifth straight season. Since 1976 in the NBA-ABA merger, the only players with five or more All-NBA first-team selections in their first six seasons are Luka, Larry Bird, Tim Duncan, and the Iceman, George Gervin.
Oh, the Iceman, huh?
And he joins Duncan and Kevin Garnett as the only players to earn five first-team selections before their 26th birthday.
Wow.
So at just 25 years old, Luka now already has more career first-team All-NBA selections than guys like Dirk, Garnett, Steve Nash, Dwayne Wade, Steph Curry, Nikola Jokic, Allen Iverson, and Chris Paul. And he's got many years ahead of him. Mavs top draft pick Derek Lively made the second-team All-Rookie squad. He's the 10th Maverick to make an All-Rookie team. Luka, Jason Kidd, Jamal Mashburn, Roy Tarpley, Sam Perkins, and Jay Vincent all made first-team All-Rookie. And Lively joins Dennis Smith, Marquise Daniels, Josh Howard, and Yogi Ferrell as Mavericks who made second-team All-Rookie.
Yogi did?
Yogi back in 2017, I think.
Boy, that's wild.
I had completely forgotten that.
But he is the most impactful rookie they have had in a long, long time.
Yogi or Derek Lively?
Lively.
Yeah. And even though defense has become one of this year's team's calling cards, not a single Maverick got even one vote for the all-defensive team. Still, in the history of the franchise, only two players have ever made the all-defensive squad, and both were second-teamers, Tyson Chandler and Derek Harper. Mm. The football world lost a notable this week when Jim Otto passed away. Known as Mr. Raider, Otto anchored the Oakland offensive line as their starting center for 15 seasons. From 1960 through 1974, he never missed a game. He played 210 straight until he retired.
Well, and I saw some footage of him this week. Double zero, that's pretty amazing. But
yep.
A single bar for a while as a center.
Can you imagine that?
And then he went double bar, and then he finally started getting a full face mask. But, I don't know, maybe first 5 or 6 years?
That's crazy. He was a 9-time All-AFL performer, was named to the NFL's 100th anniversary squad, and the Sporting News ranked him 78th on their list of the 100 greatest football players of all time. Otto was selected to the Pro Football Hall of Fame in 1980, his first year of eligibility. The great Jim Otto was 86 years old. And the hockey world lost a notable this week when Mark Wells passed away. The name may not ring a bell because Wells never played in the NHL, but he was a center iceman on the 1980 Miracle on Ice U.S. hockey team that won gold in Lake Placid. Wells centered the line with Phil Vrkata and Eric Strobel, and he recorded 2 goals and an assist at the Winter Games. He was drafted out of Bowling Green by the Canadiens, but bounced around the minors for a couple of years before retiring in 1982. Mark Wells was 67 years old.
Yeah, those guys are getting up there now that was 44 years ago.
I know. We're getting a new NHL team next season, kind of. The financially strapped Arizona Coyotes finally had their plug pulled last month. The NHL bought the team, declared them dormant, but kind of relocated the franchise to Salt Lake City, yet considering them to be an expansion team, kind of like when the Browns left Cleveland for Baltimore.
Yeah, it's really unstable.
So next season, for the first time ever, Utah will have an NHL franchise. Now, it's up to the fans in Utah to pick the team's nickname. They've been given 20 to choose from, including, you guys tell me if you like any of these,
okay.
The Utah Black Diamonds. That's
no.
A skiing
Pass.
Thing. The Utah Blast.
No.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
Utah Blizzard.
Yeah, all these sound like drinks you could get at a Dairy Queen.
The Utah Canyons.
Nope.
The Utah Caribou.
No.
Maybe. You could have an interesting mascot.
The Utah Freeze.
Yeah. What's wrong with that?
Utah.
Again, a dessert drink.
Utah Glaciers.
No.
Utah Mountaineers.
Okay.
No.
Utah Powder.
No.
Utah.
Yeah, I like that one.
Utah Swarm.
No.
Utah Venom.
Nah.
And the Utah Yeti.
That's pretty good. Baby.
I like caribou or Mountaineers.
Lots of bits available for the Yeti thing.
Yes. I think that's my favorite, too. The new team will play in the Delta Center, also home of the Jazz. In baseball this week, the Rangers got an up-close look at the Phillies, who are off to a torrid start. When they beat Texas on Wednesday, they ran their record to 36-14. That's the best 50-game start for any team since the 2001 Mariners. That team ended up winning 116 games, tying the all-time record. Seattle started 38-12 that season, so the Phillies are just two games off that record pace. And after finishing off the Rangers yesterday and sweeping Texas, the Phils have already swept seven series this young season.
Let's go, Jordan! Sorry, he just came by.
Did he really?
Yeah. Jordan Spieth just walked by the broadcast.
Oh, no. Is he?
I think
is,
he gave me thumbs up. I think he did.
Oh, yeah. He's heading way over there deep into the rough where he yanked
his drive.
He's
right down the middle. He's in the fairway. He's in great shape.
We had a very notable retirement this week in the world of competitive eating. The legendary Takeru Kobayashi, six-time Nathan's Hot Dog Eating Contest champ, announced he was hanging up his stomach at the age of 46. Kobayashi said he was worried about the damage that eating so much highly processed food has done to his body, saying he wants to repair his brain and his gut. He said he no longer has the same appetite or sense of taste or smell that he used to. His career started after he appeared on a Japanese reality TV show called TV Champion, very generic, back in 2000. On that show, he became an eating sensation when he downed 60 plates of sushi, 10 pounds of potatoes, and 16 bowls of ramen in one sitting.
Was there something with him being suspended by the hot dog league?
I don't remember that.
There was something. Yeah, I don't know. They even suspended. There's some sort of controversy with them.
Only Joey Chestnut and Mickey Sudo have more Nathan's titles than Kobayashi. This week's least competent criminal is a Boulder, Colorado woman who had been accused of stealing a car. She was eventually released on bond, but upon her release, she walked down the road, found a truck with the keys inside, and tried to steal it. She got as far as starting the truck, but when she discovered it had a manual transmission, she got out and walked off, leaving the truck to roll forward and hit a fire hydrant.
Oh my gosh.
She was arrested again and has an upcoming court date now for multiple offenses. And finally, what did one saggy boob say to the other saggy boob? If we don't get some support, people will think we're nuts.
So help you. I thought you were better than that.
That's Friday Morning Scatter Shooting, the only privately held but publicly traded radio segment on Wall Street.
Thanks for hanging out with your old pal Junior Miller for another edition of Friday Morning Scatter Shooting. We'll see you next Friday, right here on Sports Radio 96.7 and 1310, The Ticket.
Okay, in just 4 minutes in the emergency break of the week, words can be tough. What are songs about? And the rant strikes again.
It's time for the emergency break of the week.
Well, you guys have a good show. Have a good weekend.
Thank you. You too. Thanks, guys.
Hi, Junes.
All right.
Hi, Donnie.
That moment when programming is brought to a complete halt.
That's Matt. Barb. That's Donovan. They are next.
I'm Matt.
By a wheels-off comment or technical meltdown.
Thanks to Tyler.
Hi, Junes.
Thanks to Fernando.
Hi, Gordo.
And Ryan. Hey. For the great... God dang it. If you shoot that mother up one more time...
Wait, what just happened? What
did
just happened?
Did
the next bottle you throw over here is coming back at you 60 miles an hour.
Who are you talking
do it again.
To?
I'm talking to you, Gordon.
Headhunting is a coward.
That's right.
Did you hit him, Gordon?
That's a shirt he's wearing.
He is. He hit me right in the noggin.
I did not. I hit you in the shoulder, and then Craig tried to block it.
He was
trying to block it from going into the trash can, and he hit you in the head. So
headhunting is a coward.
Blame Craig.
All right.
But see, the only thing you have to do to block Gordon's shot is sit there because it's never going
in. You don't have to block his shot.
That's a shot at me.
All right. We'll see you Monday.
Let's see who yanked the break the hardest this week on The Little Ticket.
Crawford Services AC and Heating, bring us the emergency break of the week. We'll give you three candidates. You get the vote on them at 888-787-1310. By the way, Corby the champion last Friday. Is that right, Daddy?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Corby won last week when we were out of the office taking some PTO. All right. Candidate number one is the guy we were just talking to, the great Donovan. And this is actually during crosstalk. Sometimes words are hard to say. We all have words that trip us up. And Donovan has a couple of them.
You never know when you're on the road. There was a crash on the tollway, but I evaded it. I got around it, and I'm here. So right now, it's going very well.
Did you see it happen, or did you just happen upon the aftermath?
I saw the aftermath.
The what?
You said that weird.
The aftermath.
That's good.
The aftermath. I did say that weird. Is that? Do I need to add that to the list of words? I can't
say it again.
Aftermath.
Aftermath. Was that weird?
It was.
Oh my
goodness. That is kind of hard to say.
It is.
But you're putting an extra F in there or something.
Aftermath.
Yeah. That's close. Aftermath. I think that's right.
That's good. Yeah.
We'll add it to the list of words I just cannot say.
Yeah. What's the other ones?
Oh my gosh. When you, like, if you're injured and you have to go to a center.
Mm-hmm.
To get
All right, this is a good
just
start.
Add it to the list.
Aftermath and rehabilitation?
Yeah.
Is that what he's looking for? Okay. We all have them. Heck, I have a hard enough time saying Rory McIlroy.
Yeah.
I always Scooby-Doo that one. But Donovan had a couple of there. Boy, Scotty Scheffler just walked 20 feet away from us. I think he's in the right rough off of number 10T. Okay, you don't have to play that.
He's the world's number one ranked golfer and currently world's number one fugitive.
Not a fugitive. No, he's not. Okay,
fugitive is kind of hard to say.
Yeah, it kind of is. Let's write that one down. All right, there's Donnie as candidate number one. Candidate number two comes to us from the sweet spot. And this is during their crosstalk, during Wine Today Doesn't Suck. This is Sean, and he gets absolutely murdered when they bring up the Police song, Every Breath You Take. And he, for some reason, thinks it's about nuclear war or the end of the world. And they're like, what? And the only thing we can figure out is he was thinking about the Sting song, Russians, which is the whole thing about, I hope the Russians love their children too.
Yeah.
All right, but this is really funny, and now it's a drop about, I don't know, every 3 minutes when Ham is on the board.
In the year 1983, Every Breath You Take was released by the Police. It's the most played song in radio history.
Oh,
is
what
it
a
really?
Beating that song is.
Yeah, it's kind of a beating.
It's about the Cold War, right?
I mean, I like the Police, but that's not
It's about a stalker.
Yeah, it's hashtag
the
me
Cold
too.
War.
I'm also
pretty sure I'm right about that.
No, you're not at all.
No, you're wrong, bro.
Look at the lyrics.
That's you're thinking of. We Didn't Start the Fire.
How would Every Breath You Take be about the Cold War?
You're thinking of the Macarena.
Every Breath You Take. Oh, that's Eve. The Macarena. The dance craze that took over the mid-90s.
Okay,
sorry,
number
man.
One.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Oh, they're still going.
I think of the Cold War, too.
Was it Putting on the Ritz about Nam?
It was a protest song about Nam.
It predicted Nam.
Yeah.
Okay, number one.
Great.
They think that song's a beating? Every Breath You Take?
I mean, it's a great song, but we've heard it so many times.
It got overplayed, but...
Yeah.
It's about the Cold War, right?
I liked it. It was a great song.
Did you ever think it was about the Cold War?
No.
No, never thought that. Although I love Sean's.
Pretty sure it is.
That's right.
So confident.
He stuck by it. He was
so confident.
All right, one more time.
In the year 1983, Every Breath You Take was released by the Police. It's the most played
Penis.
Song in radio history.
Oh,
is
what
it
a
really?
Beating that song is.
Yeah, it's kind of a beating.
Yep. It's about the Cold War, right?
I mean, I like the Police, but that's
no.
not a beating.
It's about a creeper. Like a stalker.
Yeah, it's hashtag
the
me
Cold
too.
War.
I'm also pretty sure I'm right about
that. No, you're not at all.
No, you're Every, wrong, bro.
Oh, just look at the lyrics.
That's you're thinking of. Fuck. We Didn't Start the Fire.
How would Every Breath You Take be about the Cold War?
You're thinking of the Macarena.
Every Breath You Take.
Oh, that's
Kiev.
It. The Macarena. The dance craze that took over the mid-90s.
Sorry, man.
Yeah.
Jeez.
I think of the Cold War, too.
Was it putting on the Ritz about Nam?
It was a protest song about Nam.
It predicted Nam.
Yeah.
Man, that's funny. That is
pretty sure I'm right about it.
No, you're not.
No, no. And I love it now that any song that is brought up, Ham immediately fires off. What about the Cold War?
About the Cold War, right?
There is Sean as candidate number two. Candidate number three is Davy Lane.
Yes.
He is quick to just try to drive that hardline car right off the road. It's one thing to make a joke about the name of some sort of show or project. It's another thing to do that when the guest is being introduced on the hardline as Bob is trying to fight through this.
Only on Sports Radio 96.7 and 1310 The Ticket.
All right, it's 5:57. It's the Hardline live from the Charles Schwab Colonial, and we have big, big hockey tonight. And when we have big hockey, we need a big hockey brain. And so very high on my list of big hockey brains is the great Dmitry Filipovich, who hosts the PDO cast and
the PDO cast.
PDO cast, the hockey PDO, of course. And Dmitry joins us right now. Hi, Dmitry. How are you?
Fellas, I'm good. Just to clarify, definitely not the pedo cast.
Okay, good.
Otherwise, great intro.
I don't know what Bob's into. So.
That was on the list of names he decided not to go with. So
it was close. It was a close second.
The URL was taken, so you had to pivot. Yeah, I get it.
God, poor guy. Just trying to come on, talk some stick and puck, and just get hijacked by Davey. Okay, so that makes Davey candidate number three. So is it Donovan, Sean, or Gen X Davy Lane, who hosts his 80s prom tonight?
Yeah, that's tonight. Mm-hmm. Very exciting.
Right after the top 10 or right at? Yeah, I think so. It's right after the top 10, I do believe. All right, so you get the vote, 888-787-1310. Hello, you are on the ticket. Who wins the e-break?
Yes, is this the James McMurtry Karaoke Hotline?
It is.
I guess.
Oh, well, Ruth Ann and Lynn, they wear them cut-off britches and the little hawkers.
Don't want to do all the lyrics here. It's kind of a tense scene in Choctaw Bingo. Hmm. You know those lines, Giorgio?
I think I've heard you sing them before.
He wants to do with his cousins.
Yeah, that's your favorite line from Mississippi. Hi, you're on the ticket. Who wins the e-break? Hello?
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 Oh, no.
Hello, good morning, George.
It's Brady Tom.
Yes, it's Brady Tom.
And who you like to vote for, Brady Tom?
Hey, George, why is it such a good time to be a Dallas fan?
Why?
Because it's not football season.
Okay.
I would like to vote for Davy Lane's pedo comment.
Okay, thank you. Hello, you are on the ticket. Who wins the emergency break of the week?
Yes, I'd like to vote for speech impediment Donnie Dew and Hooter Brown.
Okay. Hello, you're on ticket radio.
Am I on IM radio?
Yes, ma'am.
Unreal.
Hi, neither. I want to vote for my leader and adopted radio friend, one Davy Lane, just so you know. And y'all have a happy, booty-splash America, and holy smog he's about.
Good God.
Well, that's an old reference. Holy smog he's about.
Holy smog he's about.
Holy shoot.
Oh, shoot. Oh, shoot. Buddhist bless America.
Buddhist bless America. Hi, you're on the ticket. Who wins?
Well, before I vote, I'd like to just wish Warren and Prescott Youngblood a very happy last day of school as their dad, Craig.
Oh, that's nice.
Is Craig there?
Yes.
So,
I'm sorry, I wasn't paying attention. What?
Whoa.
Give me a Davey.
Okay, thank you. Hello, you're on the ticket, America's favorite radio station.
Good morning, gentle musers.
Hello?
Yes.
Yes.
All right, next.
Hello, you are on the ticket, AM, FM, and stream.
Good morning, musers. I'd like to vote for Davey Lane, and you guys have a blessed day.
You too.
Thank you.
That's very nice.
This is surprising me. I thought Sean would be a slam dunk winner.
I know. I thought Donovan's pretty strong, too. Hello, you're on the ticket. Who wins the e-break?
I'll vote for Abraham Lane.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have ourselves a winner. Prom Night Davey.
Only on Sports Radio 96.7 and 1310 The Tick.
All right, it's 5:57. It's the Hardline live from the Charles Schwab Colonial. And we have big, big hockey tonight. And when we have big hockey, we need a big hockey brain. And so very high on my list of big hockey brains is the great Dmitry Filipovich, who hosts the PDO cast and
PDO cast,
the hockey PDO, of course. And Dmitry joins us right now. Hi, Dmitry. How are you?
Fellas, I'm good. Just to clarify, definitely not the pedo cast.
Okay, good.
Otherwise, great intro.
I don't know what Bob's into. So.
That was on the list of names he decided not to go with. So
it was close. It was a close second.
The URL was taken, so you had to pivot. Yeah, I get it.
I get it. All of a sudden, Bob was back on the post-game show at the compound.
Did Sean not even get a vote?
Not one vote.
That's correct.
That's amazing to me.
For thinking every breath you take is about the Cold War.
Pretty sure I'm right about that.
No, you're not at all.
No.
One of the great and Davey's performance was really good.
Sure. Yeah,
but that's
great.
One of the great robberies in e-break history, I
really
think.
Really is. But the P1, that's one of the great things about the e-break, though. It's the way it goes. The P1 gets to decide.
Obviously.
Okay, Daddy, how many wins is that for Davey?
That is Dave Lane's 16th. E-break win. He is now 121 behind Norman. I am the Cold War Hitzkiss.
Dave.
All right, way to go, Dave, and good luck with the prom show tonight.
And right now, out with the fans with the wireless is Gordo. Come in.
Hey, yes, you have me. How you doing, sir?
Good. Want an interview?
No. Yeah. Just
name is Lightning.
But Lightning. What's your last
Ben,
name?
Bolt or Bowles. So Ben Coles playing right. Ben Coles, godson right here.
Oh, that's your godson is Ben Coles. He's a golfer.
Right. Came in second at the Byron.
What do you do for a living, Lightning?
Whatever I want.
What?
Whatever I want to do.
Oh, you're retired?
Not tired.
No. Okay. You got a lot of shtick.
See you, buddy.
Okay. Thank you. How you doing, ma'am? Gordon Keith of the Ticket.
You guys had zero chemistry.
What are you walking away for? Come here.
I'm just following this group. It's okay.
Oh, listen to the accent. Where are you from?
Scotland.
Scotland. Yeah. Same here. Are Keith, you? Yeah. Donater Castle. Donater Castle. You ever heard of that?
Where?
On the North Sea. That was the Keith Castle.
Ah, there you are.
Yeah, the Earl of Marshall, 7th Earl of Marshall, was my great-great-great-grandfather. But anyway, so are you with a golfer? Like, are you a husband or wife of a golfer?
I'm a...
That was kind of awkwardly worded. Sorry about that.
That's all right. I'm following Robert McIntyre.
Robert McIntyre. Is that your boyfriend?
It is indeed, yeah.
How long have you been going out with him?
A couple of years.
How many years?
A couple of years.
Where'd you meet him?
Scotland.
Scotland. Whereabouts in Scotland?
We're from near the same area. So he's from Oban in Scotland.
Uh-huh. Oban in Scotland. Okay. And has he proposed to you yet?
No.
Do you think if he wins the Colonial, he'll propose to you?
No.
Tell her I went to Scotland this last December.
George went to Scotland this past summer.
Okay. December.
December. Sorry, this past December. He's a guy I work with. His name is George.
Have you been to Scotland?
I have been to Scotland, yes. Glasgow.
Yeah, yeah.
And Edinburgh.
Yeah, nice yeah. places. Yeah.
Did the whatever it is. What is it, the Royal Mile yeah. there? Mm-hmm. Oh, is he right there? Oh, that's him. Oh, sorry. We need to quit talking. So loud. So that's him
What's
right
he
there.
Got? What's he got for the green?
That's who?
Jorge Campillo.
Oh, never heard of him. I'm not a big golf guy.
He's even par.
Lightning, he's at even par. So how long has your boyfriend been a professional golfer? The Scottish accent is one of the greatest accents of all time. Do you agree?
Absolutely.
What do you think's one of the worst? Outside of my own.
I don't know.
What's an accent you hate?
Say Wisconsin.
Probably Wisconsin.
I don't know. I can't differentiate between states here.
Obviously.
Yeah. What about like Canadian accents? They're annoying, aren't they?
Canada.
Oh, you haven't? They say, like, instead of saying about, they say about. And plus, they're, like, annoyingly passive-aggressive. What's that?
Is this for, like, a radio?
Yeah, we're live on the radio in Dallas right now.
Nice to talk to you.
Have you studied the Kennedy assassination?
No.
Do you know who killed John F. Kennedy? Know the name of the assassin?
I can't. I remember studying it, but I can't remember the name.
Lee Harvey Oswald?
I'm gonna. No, I can't remember that one.
No, that's not his name. That's just kind of a sign off that I give.
Wow, her boyfriend was eighth at the PGA
Your boyfriend
Championship.
Was eighth yeah, in the PGA Championship.
He's a promising
did you know that?
Player.
He did, yeah.
He's a promising new player, in my opinion.
He's good. Yeah.
He's very good. He
won some Mad
he won
Skrilla.
Some Mad Skrilla at that
Yo.
Event.
What's that?
Like money.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was good.
Are you in charge of the finances in the household?
No.
You guys live together?
Mostly, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. He went to McNeese State.
He went to McNeese State.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. He did. Yeah.
I'm a big fan of McNeese State.
Lake Charles.
That's where Joe
Lake
Dumars
Charles.
Went.
Yeah. That's where Joe Dumars went.
It's his birthday today.
It's his birthday today. Yeah, he's like 61 or something like that. Do you guys want to have like Scottish children?
Maybe one day.
Or maybe anyway, different okay. children, American
nice
children?
To talk to you.
Okay. Yep. Okay, thank you.
Okay, right. She's at it with you.
Okay,
hung in there for a while.
Yeah. We ran into a player's significant other. I'd say that's quite a find.
Yeah.
Let me ask this person. Are you married to a PGA golfer?
No, not anymore.
Okay, thank you. I ask this young man here.
Not anymore.
How you doing, sir?
Doing great.
What's your name?
Chase Hatfield.
How old are you, Chase?
I'm 14.
14. Are you a golfer?
Yes, sir.
You are? Who's your favorite golfer out here? Who do the young people...
I like Scheffler. I'm going over to walk to see him.
Bandwagoner.
Uh-oh. Yeah, did you, like, you collect Scotty Scheffler type stuff? You know, he's coming out with his signature line of handcuffs and all that stuff?
Okay.
No, I haven't.
Oh, did you hear about his arrest?
I did, yes.
Yeah. What do you think about that? You think they're bogus charges?
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah. You got to fight the man, don't you?
Definitely.
Yeah. Which one's the man in this case? Is it the police or the rich white guy? Tough one, isn't it?
Yeah.
it's tough. So how long have you been playing golf?
I just kind of started up like this year and last year, mm-hmm. but I mean, I've been playing like whatever.
Does your dad play golf too?
He does.
Is he pretty good or are you already better than him?
He's pretty good.
Ask him where he likes to hack it around.
Where do you like to hack it around? You have a favorite course?
Well, I'm going to go at Colonial after the finish.
Oh, really? That's pretty cool.
Yeah. I'm going to go to Colonial, but... Lately, I've been, like, at Rivercrest and Shady uh-huh. Oaks and all them.
Oh, Shady Oaks. Okay.
What's your handicap right now?
I don't have one, but probably up in the 20s.
Tell him to drive for show and putt for dough.
I'll give you a piece of advice, a little golf advice. Drive for
show
putt and
for
putt
dough.
For dough. You into baking and things like that?
Okay.
Good. All right. Well, thank you, Chase. Appreciate it.
All right.
You want to give a shout-out to your friends or you have a girlfriend yet?
I'm talking to someone.
Okay, oh. So that's a good first
talking
step.
Talking to someone. Yeah. Talking to someone. Okay. How long have you been talking to her?
Like 3 weeks right now.
All right.
Okay.
All right. Chase, you got it going on, man. All right. Cool, man.
We call that groundwork.
Take care. All right. Chase is slaying.
Playing golf, talking to a girl.
Yeah, talking to girls. About to join Colonial in 3 weeks. It's all happening for him.
Man.
All right. No one's else here.
Okay. So. Well, good job, Gordo.
Hey, thank you.
Get the Steak Podcast at patreon.com/sportsgreek.
Thank you, Craig Miller. And I'd like to welcome you guys out to the Colonial.
Oh, thank you.
And to Fort Worth in general, because this is kind of my hometown. It's my hometown. I've made it my home for, 40 years now. So that happened. Okay, fantastic Friday fan feedback, 888-787-1310 is our telephone number. If you'd like to reach us telephonically or if you'd like to reach us by email, I'm Tom Gribble at 1310.net. And George is also Tom Gribble at 1310.net. You can also reach us on Twitter, and we have a Discord.
My sandwich is fell apart.
And everywhere. Okay, so we talked about how millennials are doing workarounds to have unlimited PTO, except they're not even taking the PTO because they don't want the stigma of taking PTO, so they just don't work that day, but schedule a few emails to go out to look like they're working. There's also some devices that P1's sent me a link to.
They're kind of redefining what work means.
Which is awesome. Because that basically what we want to get to in the world is where all of us are just scamming each other out of money and time and resources. And that all we do, everybody's job is to be an OnlyFans person for someone else.
Right.
And just, we all have our OnlyFans account. And we all specialize in something because there's fetishes for everything.
Yeah, there's fetishes for,
yeah. So I'm going to start an OnlyFans. It's like a bearded guy cutting birthday cake with his feet.
You know, with all the people that have a foot fetish, how have I not monetized that with my beautiful feet?
You absolutely
could. This
guy
is crazy.
Now, you have to be, I mean, it's not just easy, though. Like, the really successful OnlyFans people, they work their tails off and they have to do a lot of private communication with people who pay you for that, and so you'll be dealing with a lot of guys. Yeah. And
Rex Ryan.
Yeah. So when you're having to do your private chats with the guy who's really into your feet and telling him how handsome and successful he is all the time.
I don't want to do that.
His ego.
Who wants you to do a production with him?
I just want the money without all the work.
I just want to post pics.
Well, you can do that. Sure. There's a way to do it. You won't make as much, but that's okay.
Okay.
Well, several P1s sent me links to these devices that are called mouse jigglers. And what it does is it moves your mouse. And I don't know. I'm going to be speaking very ignorantly here because I don't know all this Microsoft Teams and even Slack and all this stuff that people use for corporate America. I don't know it so much. So, but there's something to where you have to keep moving your mouse so it keeps you maybe logged in or makes it look like you're active or something.
Yeah.
I don't know. But there's a little device that you plug in your computer, then you can leave for the day, and it moves your mouse around all day, I guess. It's pretty genius that we come up with products that we buy with money that we get from the job that we're trying to scam that we plug up to make it look like we're working for them. It's pretty genius.
Yeah.
I like that. So thanks to the people who sent me those links. For those who heard us at... Oh, I'd also like to thank the people who had us out here in this Patriot tent. What is this called? Patriot Place?
Outpost.
Patriot Outpost. So this is for all active military, right?
There's former veterans out here. Yeah.
For some reason, I thought that the guy told me out there that he was in the military, but he's no longer in the military, so he couldn't get in here.
Huh. We talked to a couple of veterans. They were in their 60s.
I guess so. Makes sense. And on Memorial Day, which is different than Veterans Day,
right?
We should acknowledge this is not the day to go up and thank a veteran.
Right.
This is a day to visit perhaps a national cemetery.
Correct.
For people who have given their life in service of this country. But thanks to the people who had us out here at the Patriot Place. Place
Outpost
at Colonial. Now, as I walked around outside of the Patriot Outpost, ran into that Scottish girlfriend of the famous golfer
Robert McIntyre.
And they've been dating for a couple years. And in talking to her, I'm just reminded of how much I love my home accent of Scotland, the Scottish accent.
We got a lot of homes.
I know. Which, Fort Worth, for those who don't know, Fort Worth is where Scotland began. And so I did some research on what is the sexiest accent on a woman of a female of their choosing assigned.
And we're talking worldwide now, because recently you had that survey about American accents,
right,
the sexiest.
And surprisingly, the Southern accent scored the highest on sexiness.
Not surprising.
You don't think that's surprising?
No, because there are no other contenders.
What do you mean?
In America,
Midwestern accent?
That's not sexy.
But it's not sexy, which is what the Southern accent sometimes is.
No, I think the Southern accent is the only one that can be sexy, because the Northeast accent is not sexy. The Midwestern isn't. The California isn't.
You don't like the Valley Girl?
No,
accent?
That's not sexy. No.
Really?
No.
Huh.
That was a one-horse race.
Man, I disagree with you there. There's lots of good
now
female of their choosing accents.
Worldwide? Now we have a race.
All right, so in this survey, they tried to find out. Now, this is actually to English-speaking countries. Okay, so this is not speaking English with a foreign accent.
Okay.
Just this particular list that I have here. Do you want to guess what is the sexiest male accent and the sexiest female accent, according to this study of science?
All right, if it's just English speaking, I would guess British is going to rank near or at the top for both.
I bet it's number one for what men like. For women, I bet Scottish is number one.
Okay. That the male Scottish accent,
yes,
is number one.
Yeah, because of the whole Outlander thing.
What's that?
Some show that women's like.
Uh-oh. Sounds like that show
something
is
that I know
is a pox upon your house.
That's fine. I've never watched it. It's fine.
Okay. The sexiest male accent, according to this, was the Scottish accent.
Very good,
so
George.
Giorgio was right. Giorgio knows what's sexy on a man. And it's the Scottish accent. Once again, if you're just joining us to our V1s out there, I'm Scottish.
Shows that I know.
I'm Scottish.
Shows that I know women.
In origin. And number two on the male accent is the posh accent, the received pronunciation, you know, the British, the standard British one, not the, all that Cockney East Ender stuff, but the posh accent. And then Irish was third on the male accent in terms of sexiness. For women's is of females of their own assigned, number one, Irish.
Okay.
Wasn't the Scottish.
Wow.
Despite what I told Rory McIntyre's girlfriend that I ran into.
It's really surprising to me.
Irish considered sexier than Scottish. Huh. As a matter of fact, when you look at this particular list, second is the posh accent, so the Princess Di sounding accent. Then Geordie accent, then Brummy, and then the Mancunian, then Other. Then Scottish comes in at seventh.
Behind Other.
Yeah.
Huh.
Really low for the female Scottish accent. And you have to admit, though, the Irish accent's a pretty good one.
That's great.
Yeah.
On the women's, and it ranks pretty high, you know, on the men's, too.
I've never thought of it as being a sexy accent for a woman, though, the Irish accent?
Mm-hmm.
Huh.
Yeah.
Sure. What do you think is the sexiest accent for a non-English-speaking country?
Speaking English?
Speaking English. Like when you hear a French woman or an Italian woman or a Spanish woman speaking English. Or Scandinavian.
I think that the isn't the like the Australian accent kind of sexy?
Yeah, that's
for a woman.
That's so close to British though, and that's English speaking. I'm talking about non-English speaking.
That's right. So South African also, you got to throw that. Yeah. Oh, they speak Afrikaans there.
Yeah, but let's throw it out because it's mainly English.
Is it really?
Yeah.
They're not just speaking English with an Afrikaans accent? I mean, I don't know the answer to this.
I don't either, but I think English is their number one language.
Is the main language in South Africa is English?
I believe so.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I didn't know. French?
Yeah, I wish we knew.
Italian?
I think French may be higher than Italian, right?
I don't know. I'm going to go Italian.
Hmm.
And women are suckers for guys with British accents,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
That's what they like the best?
Yes.
Like American women I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm.
They love guys with British accents and anyway, that idiotic accent the guys are putting on. And then what do you think is... Don't you think the Irish look, though, of the flowing red hair is good-looking, though, on a girl-woman choosing?
Give me an example. Is there a famous movie star or musician? Who's
the example I was going to give you was problematic, but it was the first Irish girl that popped in my head.
Sinead O'Connor?
No, not her flowing locks.
Roma Downey?
No, not... Is Roma Downey Irish?
I thought she was.
Huh.
Allie Hewson.
Oh, that's Bono's wife, who doesn't have flowing red locks.
Roma Downey is indeed
Roma Downey
British.
Jr. is, okay.
She's right, not
did,
Irish.
Did
she's
you know
British.
That there's...
No, she is Irish.
Okay, I have a list of words I want George to read.
All
read
right.
down that list and read it out loud, because this is part of a two-parter here.
With tired head, too. Parallelogram. Burglary, generally. Purple burglar alarm. Regularly. Curly whirly. Tarantula. Mirror, specific vocabulary murder. Jewelry. Diagonally. Honorary.
Pretty good.
Listen
to a Scottish guy try to pronounce this stuff. This woman recorded her boyfriend, who's Scottish. She's from Maryland. She's American. Trying to read those phrases.
Tarantula. Burger. Purple. Bricks. Vocabulary. Burglary. 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 I think.
Burglary.
Murder.
Did you catch murder in there?
Butter. Barrel.
Barrel.
I can't say it.
Barrel.
Leg yellow.
That was supposed to be barrel.
Bottle.
Leg yellow. Regularly.
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 Boy, R's
regular,
and L's just tripped them out.
Regularly.
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 Regularly. Sounds like I'm swallowing cough medicine.
Sounds like you're gurgling water.
World. Could you hear my whole world?
Ooh,
world.
Curly burly. You put burly there. There's a difference between burly and burly. The burden purple murderer versus the preferred federal. The burden purple murderer.
Okay, I can't take anymore.
That is
wow.
English.
That's amazing.
It's a native English speaker.
And, wow.
And because of that accent, they can't say
the
R's and they cannot say.
God.
Purple burglar alarm is particularly tricky for them.
Wow.
Mother. Wild.
Crazy. All right, Gordo. Thank you.
It's Monto.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, Justice.
We have five candidates to get to here on the NIT break, so let's get going.
Let's do it.
We start with our very own Ham.
Yeah.
Ham is nominated. We all know he's an assassin. He's the devil. We love him and we hate him. He did what maybe one of his best tricks, turning around a quick drop and shot the wheels off the invasion.
Top 15 paid in the NBA for the 23-24 season, and there's only one in the Final Four.
All right.
That is nuts. I just saw that and had to bring it up.
That's extensive nuts, yes.
Yeah, yeah. And we'll talk way more with Joe Trahan about the Stars and the Mavs. But you've been talking about this for a while because your son goes to a private school. He plays baseball.
Yeah.
And they had a night to where they had the kids play against the parents. Am I getting everything correct so far?
Okay. Yeah, and he goes to a really small school out on the west side of Fort Worth. And I thought this was really cool because the school didn't have a baseball team until this year because enough of the dudes in the grade wanted to play. Like, there's only like 20 kids in his grade. Like, it's tiny.
That's extensive nuts, yes.
Yeah. That was quick.
Extensive nuts.
I just turned my headphones off, and I was like, did I just hear that?
reminds me if you see an old person. But
okay,
his coach, I thought this was great.
Okay, Ham.
His coach decided that let's have a, like, their season is over, they're done.
Awesome.
So that had to happen, like, right at 12:29, and he sees he's like, all right, the logger's about to get this 12:30.
And I could have probably played it sooner, too, but
no,
I had to wait
right
for it to work.
Yeah, you had to wait for your window and then just throw it in there. That's
awesome.
Extensive nuts. Perfect. Good work, Ham.
That's extensive nuts, yes.
Yeah. Yes.
All right, there is our very own little Ham. We have a combo platter of Matt McLaren here. This will be invasion heavy, FYI.
Okay.
The first one here from Matt McLaren has a hard time with a word.
That at least 11 children have been born in Antarctica, the first being born January 7th of 1978.
That's the first child born there, huh?
Yeah.
Well, now, did they have a hard time catching him because he's born on the ice and he just kept going?
He shoots out
and
get
that
baby!
Yeah.
Oh, no! And then he falls down into an ice crevice, and that's where the abominable snowman's
the
from.
What? The
snowman? Abominable snowman.
There you go. I think that third one was
a Yeti. I should have just said
that. Yeah, a Yeti. Go with a Yeti. All right, that's the news.
Abominable snowman.
The Obama snowman.
Yes.
Obama. Abominable. I've never had to spell that word.
Yeah.
How do you...
Why would you?
I don't know. Maybe you're writing a tale about...
How do you... Okay, go ahead. A bomb...
Little Yeti fiction? I don't know.
Okay, so abominable is one word. It's not like like, oh, I saw an abominable...
No, not Daddy.
I saw abominable snowman.
Huh.
All right.
That's a tricky one.
You just got to rush through it.
Abominable snowman.
Abominable snowman.
Candidate number three here, Matt McLaren, once again. This time, he gets caught up on a word and perhaps offends Donovan.
It seems like that's always honored, the shotgun.
Should be.
It's like dibs.
Not
dibs
with mom.
And shotgun.
Oh, yeah. Not with mom.
Mom wins.
Well, my mom can't ride in the back seat. So she always tells my wife, hey, you know what, I'm sorry. I hate to put you in the back seat of your own car, but...
She gets car sick.
Yeah, she's very claustrophobic. I don't know what the difference is, but
it's her deal.
It's my mom. I can't argue with it.
What if it's a bitch she's just been doing to make sure she rides past?
She just wants shotgun.
You said a bitch.
I did too. I was like, pretty harsh, man.
It's
pretty harsh.
It's just shotgun. It's not that big a deal.
I audibly said bitch.
Boy,
it sounded.
We need to review that because
it sounded wrong. Oh, it sounded like a really wrong thing to say.
Thing just flipped over too.
I thought Donnie was about to whoop your ass in there.
I'd have to let him too. If I had said that, I wouldn't even try to fight.
I was going
to
six six James.
It's time to go.
What a mess!
It did sound like bitch,
man. I heard that.
It did.
I heard that in real time. So when you played that, I was trying to hear bit, and all I heard was bitch again.
Yeah.
Do you have that isolated by chance?
It's her deal.
It's my mom. I can't argue with it.
What if it's a bitch she's just been doing?
I still hear it's a bit she's doing.
She's been doing.
It's a bit, when you, yeah. It's he a just combined the words.
He did.
Wow. There's a lot there. We got some code switch and Daddy.
Oh, great. Definitely had code switch Daddy at the end.
How so? What do you? What, I didn't catch that one.
Oh, really?
Yeah, let's.
Huh.
Interesting. That,
I thought Donnie was about to whoop your ass in there.
All right.
Whoop your ass.
Whoa.
All right, number four.
Good week.
Candid number four here is Donovan. Again, the invasion having a hard time with words.
Yeah. I haven't seen a second of Young Sheldon, so
I don't know a single person that's watched a second of Young Sheldon. And it's been on for 10 years.
It's now on
so.
Reruns all the time.
Are they ending also?
Well, this Crosstalk.
I think so. I think they're re-spinning off another one in the Sheldon universe.
Is Crosstalk made Sheldon? Teenage Sheldon?
Something like that, dude.
Pubes.
Whoa.
Well, probably shouldn't stop at that. What a weird show.
Yeah, all right.
For network TV, very odd.
What are we showing here?
On NBC this fall, pubes.
That's on Spice.
It takes a while to get going, but it'll grow on you.
Okay.
Huh? Nice.
This Crosstalk is brought to you by Mint Dentistry.
That's pretty good.
Cam already said that.
Yeah.
I didn't hear it.
Yes, as I just said.
Just an odd segue.
Why are Crosstalks always just chaotic?
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
With
they're
us in the invasion.
Feeding grounds for
the
that.
The musers in the invasion. Also, Mark, when Sean said, coming to NBC this summer, pubes.
Write that down, Ham.
Yeah, write it down.
Write
please.
That down.
All right, our last
turn
one here
around.
Is a little bit of a longer one, but it's worth the payoff because Corby was starting the hard line at 3:30. We got Portugal the Man going, but he was not ready. And you'll hear in the middle, it seems like the wheels are back on, but then they fall right back off. Here we go.
He doesn't know we're back on the air as we start the show.
Sorry.
That was a real live Sun Chip crunch.
You're so mean. Everyone's so mean.
God. Good stuff, Corby.
All right, it's 3:39 here on Sports Radio 96.7, 1310, The Ticket. This is The Hardline. 5.0 here today on this Tuesday, here today on this May 21st, and here today in studio for the final time this week.
Oh, man.
As we get you prepared for them games. Tomorrow we'll be at Fan and Tree Farm, and the next 2 days after that, we'll be at Colonial.
Nothing says Western Conference Finals like Colonial.
I know.
In a weird way, though, it does. That's the tradition unlike any other, because my first spring here, I remember doing hockey post-game shows.
First team to four.
From the Nelson and the Colonial.
Yeah.
Like, it's kind of built into the playoff member berries from the good old days.
And you know what? I think that
although
it just...
Although the Nelson has changed a little bit since then.
Oh, my God.
Are you choking on a Sun Chip?
Oh, wait, the Sun Chip just went down the wrong pipe.
Medic!
Feels like Corby wasn't prepared for the start of the show.
No, and...
I mean, it all started with missing the Dan Bennett meeting.
Unbelievable. Mm.
So, got pile
it's
on
radio
there
karma.
At the end. But
radio karma for missing the meeting.
What happened,
last one to jump on the pile.
According to witnesses, was as Portugal the Man is playing, Corby is stuffing his face with a sandwich and just sitting there watching the TV like a dolt. And then later on, again, according to eyewitness accounts, he thought Bob was going to go on a Bob tangent and took another bite of sandwich, which is why he choked her at the end when he... realized he has to actually talk.
He had to talk. Wow.
Yeah. Incredible.
So was that okay? So was that first Sun Chip bite a drop of the chip crunch? Because we do have that drop. Or was
yeah,
because
I was looking at him eating.
Okay. Okay, that was actual real crunch?
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Awesome. All right.
I'm ready to vote.
All right, we got Ham, Double McLaren, Donovan, and
man,
Corby. Sean,
this is tough
week. Let's get your vote load.
I think Sun Chip Corby is, I mean, the twofer we get there, the beginning and the end is just... That's rare stuff.
All right. Mm. Mino?
I would like to defer to be the last deciding vote because this one's tough. Get, okay. Come back to me.
You're that guy at the table, huh?
I am.
All right. Him.
I'm thinking about it.
Give me pubes.
Or give you death?
Or give me death.
Lando?
I mean, I would like to vote for all of them, but if I had to pick, I would go puberty pubes.
Mm. Puby, puby. Okay. I think I would go with McLaren Abominable. So, Mina, we're back to you.
Okay,
you
so I get this? To make I get to make the decision.
Well, there is a winner right now, but go ahead.
He gets to make his decision.
Yeah, I'm going to take pubes also.
Okay.
All right, Donovan.
A lot of us like that
Donovan.
On the show.
And his pubes and young Sheldon. Win the NIT break. That is win number two for Donovan all time.
Congratulations, Donovan, and thank you, Justin. It's 252. Why Today Doesn't Suck is next.
Once again, the ticket presents Why Today Doesn't Suck.
Sucking on chili dog. Sucking on a dog. Sucking on a chili dog. Sucking on chili. Sucking on a dog. Sucking on a chili dog, sucking on chili dog.
And now, here are your hosts, Sean Bass and David Mino.
On NBC this fall.
Oh, Ham.
You know what? I love him so much. Summer chill. We're doing a five-part harmony of chili dog.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Sucking on a chili dog.
Yeah.
What's that from?
I don't know. The internet?
Yeah, it's about the Cold War.
It might be. So, leave the guy alone.
He likes it now. He embraces
one
it.
One mistake.
It's fun.
I can't really hear anybody here.
Yeah,
I can hear the station.
I really can't either. We're
like,
just kind of
what's going on
with
that?
Things are tough.
He's
in
he's
the D.
Okay, now we're, okay. Now we're making progress.
All right, sweet spot. We are at the Charles Schwab Challenge on a Friday.
Schwab.
So shout out to the good folks at Charles Schwab.
Is Charles Schwab alive?
Yeah, I met him earlier. I call him Chuck. Good dude.
Old Chucky, yeah.
Thank you, no.
And 3 o'clock.
He is.
Hamster Boney.
It blows my mind every time I think about that.
Thank you, Mino. Eatsy's Market
and
Bakery. GiveMeTheVin.com. Corby brings you Comedy Genius Monty.
I think he's 80-something. Yeah. And I think he lives on Pebble Beach. Who knew? But, yeah, when I found out he was alive, I kind of thought he was alive during the Depression.
I thought you guys put him in the Trifecta Lakes a couple weeks ago. No, he's...
No.
Is he in the hole?
He beat you out for a job at ESPN.
We think... No, that's Stump the Schwab. Charles Schwab and Stump the Schwab are two different people.
He is 86 and worth
and gorgeous,
$10.6 billion according to Forbes.
Dang,
more than you, Bob.
Good old Chuck.
Is Forbes still alive?
Like Jim Forbes,
Fred Forbes,
Teve Torbs.
Did I introduce Ham yet? I don't know.
Yeah, he did it all.
Oh, okay,
here's Monty.
All right. Well, there is the hard line. They are out there. Mid-golf.
You can expect this kind of gold for the rest of the afternoon.
We got Bob, Corby, and Dave. Today is May 24th,
Corby.
The 145th day of 2024, 221 days left in the year. On this date in 1899, the first auto repair shop opened in Boston. And they overcharged them by 3 shillings. Right,
okay.
Right, guys?
Is that a Kurt Schilling joke?
No. He's no laughing matter. In 1935, we had the first ever Major League Baseball game to be played at night as the
never
Cincinnati
work.
Reds beat the Phillies.
You can't see.
It'll never work.
You can't see.
It's too dark.
Oh, wow, now I can. What are those? In the year 1961, a group of freedom riders were arrested after arriving at a bus terminal in Jackson, Mississippi, in charge of breaching the peace and driving away from designated areas.
You know, we don't need to, every time we hear the word freedom rider, L4G, think of Maud.
Yeah. Well, you do you.
What about Lady Godiva, though?
True.
And you do you, because Maude's coming in my mind every time.
Gross.
So to speak.
On your face. In 1969, the Beatles' Get Back single went number one and stayed number one for 5 weeks.
Get back, you don't know me like that.
Great song. Would hold up in today's rock and roll world. Like, that's a great rock and roll song that's timeless.
Ludacris covered it.
Yeah, what if they just decided to take a left turn back in 69 and just throw out
Get back, mother, you don't know me like that.
Jeez, the Beatles have really...
You like that Ludacris commercial, by the way? The State Farm one?
Yeah, why not?
I think it's funny.
He looks kinda small.
He's tiny.
How
he's
tall
like
is he?
5'6". He's always been.
Well, you know,
not
it's
that
about
small.
The Cold War.
It's dad humor.
The Ticket's own Ludacris.
Yeah.
So pretty sure I'm right about that.
No, you're not at all.
No.
Said I was pretty sure.
At all.
I was pretty sure.
I'm going to leave. You mean roll out? No.
On this date in 1970, British guitarist Peter Green quit Fleetwood Mac to rejoin a religious cult.
Mm. Really good move because, you know.
Yeah. What'd they ever do?
Yeah. Like, you look at the net worth of Fleetwood Mac
cheated
now.
On each other.
It's like $300-400 million each.
And they all broke up. They hated each other.
You know that the guitar that Peter Green played is like the most expensive guitar ever bought.
Does Jim Irsay own it?
Oh, no. Kirk Hammett from Metallica owns it.
Okay.
Still in Metallica, by the way.
Yeah.
Good, Lando.
Can I say something that I think is bullshit?
So, on this Peter Green, pretty influential. That's all I'm saying. So you can go crap on him all you want.
No, yeah, he's a huge deal. In 2022... This is no laughing matter, Mr. Man.
Very
19
serious.
Children and two teachers were shot and killed at Robb Elementary School in Uvalde.
I don't
Way
like
to
that.
Go, Corby.
Why do
I'll
you have
get
to do
Uvalde
that?
In a minute.
That was before game one of the Western Conference Finals?
Yeah.
That's a pregame?
Too, yeah, it happened like right before the pregame. It was a really awkward pregame show we had. Remember that?
Steve Kerr had quite some thoughts before that game.
He did.
And then Kevon Looney had like 19 and 13 against us. Mm.
Sports!
He wasn't honoring the memory.
Not at all.
What are you doing?
Yeah, let's...
I'd like to apologize.
And we dumped it, too. We caught it in time.
Goodness.
P1 birthday is today. Friday. The Ticket Twins want to congratulate their P1 cousin Chad on the birth of his twin boys, Bowen and Beckham. Future backup Ticket Twins. May they grow into good P1s who also respond to their parents with no bitch. That from Peyton.
Okay.
All right, birthdays today.
Okay.
Turning 86. It's Tommy Chong's birthday.
86?
Oh. Cheech and Chong.
And gorgeous.
Did you have him as Charles Schwab's age?
No.
And could they have just switched spots in life and ended up in the same place?
I mean, there was probably a time in the 70s where... the net worth of Tommy Chong was more than Charles Schwab.
I'm going to say no.
I don't know, man.
Yeah?
No.
If we were playing, by mid-70s, that's when Schwab really took hold.
If we were playing Alive or Dead, I probably would have said dead.
So you're saying the mid-70s is when rich people started?
No. When his fund or whatever became
It changed
50,
Wall Street, Bob, and you can find it.
I'll
the story
say.
50 years ago, when he was 35, Tommy Chong was about as big as you could get.
I'll say Schwab never had to make his own meal. I'll say the...
So you think he came from money?
It's probably a safe guess. It doesn't mean it's true, but if I had to wager a guess, I would say...
So he didn't bootstrap it, is what you're saying.
I would say there's a chance he got a break or two in early life.
Sperm.
Or? He might have sold lemonade out on his driveway and
true.
Built $10 billion.
His father was a lawyer in Yolo County, yeah. Which sounds badass.
Heck yeah.
That does. Sounds like the best county.
Well, thanks for that update.
We're still keep it moving. On the air.
Yeah,
I mean, there's got to be more about his life we can get to. I'm just waiting.
No, yeah. drive the train. Yeah.
All right, Bob Dylan's 83. Patti LaBelle is 80. Priscilla Presley, 79.
There was a time.
Nice beaver.
Nice beaver indeed.
And that time is not now.
She just had it stuffed.
She's 79. Yeah.
Thank you.
She's been stuffed.
Turning 77 today, Albert Bouchard, the drummer for the Blue Oyster Cult.
Look at Scotty making a run.
The cowbell guy? Gotta be.
No,
right?
They had a separate cowbell guy.
That guy died early on in heroin.
Yeah.
Alfred Molina, 71. The actor, Doc Ock. Doug Jones is 64. He plays the Baron in What We Do in the Shadows.
Oh, that guy's great.
What a weird role.
He just wants to hang out with that gargoyle thing.
The first vampire.
Yeah, but he looks like a gargoyle. John C. Reilly is 59.
Nice beaver. Okay.
Greatness.
Thank
describes
you.
Describes the open.
Dewey Cox.
The drum set.
Very underrated.
So
Carl Payne.
You know, his house was built by Custer.
C. Payne.
Is 55. He from Martin and The Cosby Show. Will Sasso is 49.
Greatness.
Mad TV?
Yeah. We met him.
Kids these days won't understand the greatness of Mad TV.
I agree. Underrated.
Yes.
Stewart.
Had some good stuff.
Matt
Miss Swan.
Miss Swan was great.
The competitive good eater, bits. 32. Turning 39 today, it's Penny Barber's birthday.
Wow.
Penny has been familiar.
Penny Barber
in 350 films.
Uh-huh.
Such as Diaper Sex with Trans Baby Doll Natalie Mars.
Really?
We Spank in This Household. Queens of Cream. MILF Shakes. All I Want for Christmas is Ann Al.
Hey, guys.
Hi,
I'm going to need a drop here, Ham.
Is that on the Hallmark Channel? The seasonal?
How to Help a Perv. The Daddy Story. And...
Dude, that's...
Do you have my drop ready? Play it again. Pancakes for Lewd Mommy's Breakfast.
I don't think your dad's happy
that's,
with her.
That's
line
the
of
Hallmark
work.
Movie.
Oh, yeah. True.
And cool there one. Is, as always, an accompanying photo if you'd like
is
to see
a
what Penny Barber looks
recipe?
Like.
As Corby picks up his phone.
Yeah, here
opens
she
his
is.
Text messages
from Matt Birmingham. Here is Penny Barber. Oh.
Uh-huh.
Apparently, this is one is a big fan of yours, Bob. As she has...
She has a sturm stack?
Brett and Hull
oh.
tattooed on her knees.
Is that a Nike swoosh I see?
Sibian.
Oh.
Feels like this bit has run its
every
course.
Day.
And also a nod to you, Bob. She's doing the PJ Washington pose. I know you're a big fan of him.
I'm a huge fan.
Sports.
She's ready for game 2 tonight.
Of PJ.
I'm also a fan.
We'll give you one for the right price. Joe DeMar, 61. Pat Verbeek, 60.
Little ball of hate.
Little beaker.
Mr. Bart Colon is 51. Tracy McGrady, 45. Joey Logano, 34.
Colone had a great
NASCAR.
Monty, Tracy McGrady's birthday. What are you doing?
Yeah, he played for too many rivals.
Wasn't he your goat once?
No.
Do you have a lazy eye?
Yeah.
He's a pitcher, too. Didn't he take on baseball after his career?
Did he?
I think he played a little bit. Some minor league baseball.
Probably the best basketball-turned-baseball player ever, I would bet. Matt Stoney, I'm already read him. Cheeto Bay Owuzie, 29.
Cheeto
Bay.
Born on this day, now dead.
Back. Wait, I have a birthday before you get to the deads.
Where's the Cheeto sign?
Now?
I feel like Tennessee, maybe?
Not only is my friend's birthday today, it is my Chinese friend's birthday.
Whoa.
And not just any Chinese friend, my full-blown Chinese
not
80%. Friend.
Blown.
Having a full-blown birthday.
Not 90%.
YJ Sun turns 50 on Sunday. YJ,
how about that?
I love you, buddy.
How many is that in Chinese years?
I think it's still 50. I don't think
there's no conversion rate.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Isn't it up to his wife to determine if he's a full blown Chinese?
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Again.
And not if he's married.
Yeah.
Right. Mm.
Happy birthday, YJ.
You know what I'm saying?
Born on this day, now dead, a Queen of Victoria. Heavy D.
Donnie.
Daniel Gabriel Fahrenheit, who, as you may have guessed, invented Pringles.
Celsius.
Day on this day, still dead.
It's a badass last name, yeah. Fahrenheit. I'm going to change my name.
Edward Duke Ellington.
We'll call you Mr. Fahrenheit.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Tina Turner.
Five. Great Tina Turner.
That's why today doesn't
suck. Hi, I'm Tina Turner for the Tuna Turner.
Bye, Justin. Bye, golf.
See you. Let's go.
And here he is, Dave.
Thank you.
Hey, Dave.
Hey. Notable death. Shocking. As I did not realize that he was ill, but documentary filmmaker Morgan Spurlock died yesterday in upstate New York at the tender age of 53 due to complications of cancer.
Ah.
So.
Friend of the show.
Spurlock, did he do anything else that I know of besides Super Size Me?
Well, he was very busy, but nothing hit like that. So. Super Size Me was 2004, and it, of course, documented his experience eating only McDonald's food for 30 days, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And if they offered him the Super Size option at checkout, he had to say yes. And so he claimed by the end of the 30 days, he had gained 25 pounds, and he suffered from depression and liver dysfunction.
And then...
were they dumping alcohol on the French fries or something? How does your liver suffer from
that? Well, there were reports that he was drinking heavily during that time.
Oh. So. He got an FX show out of it called 30 Days.
Yes, yeah. So,
oh, that's right.
And that was a pretty good bit, but I think they ran out of ideas.
Yeah.
But it was like you're in a big city in the Midwest and you have to survive on minimum wage for 30 days to try to get a feel for it. I think a Christian dude had to go live with a Muslim family for 30 days. You know, just kind of...
30 women in 30 days.
Early reality show stuff, and it was kind of an interesting concept that I'm not sure lasted very long.
Yeah, so Super Size Me, for a documentary, it made an impressive $22 million at the global box office, and shortly after, McDonald's discontinued the Super Size option. So that
it doesn't exist on the menu anymore?
No, they just have small, medium, large fry.
Huh.
And so, yeah, following Super Size Me, he had his own production company, Warrior Poets. And so he produced and directed nearly 70 films and series, including 30 Days. Also, Where in the World is Osama Bin Laden, about the war in Afghanistan. Also, he did Super Size Me 2, Holy Chicken, about corporate farming versus family farms.
Huh.
So, anyway.
He was a friend of Bad Radio. We had him on several times.
You know he got canceled?
No.
Yeah, during Me Too, he
I guess he felt like...
Not bad radio.
He felt like enough women had dirt on him that he needed to get out ahead of it. And so he wrote an essay apologizing for all the times that he was misogynistic and making predatory sexual advances.
There's a guy who can't sleep at night.
He said that he was suffered from serial infidelity or something like that. And then, yes, there were some sexual misconducts beyond that that were really Me Too-y. And like whatever company was like, well, okay, we'll see you later then. Thank you.
Well, if you're going to tell on yourself, then we will just rip up this contract.
So who's on the Bad Radio Hall of Fame? Jared from Subway. Yeah.
Name your best friends
from that
era.
Morgan Spurlock. Who else?
Pol Pot.
Yeah, we did a weekly show with Pol Pot.
Epstein, for sure.
We never had Epstein on. You could find some guests we probably shouldn't have had on, but
Bob Knight.
Come on.
That's nothing.
He had great
compared
stories.
To these?
He had great stories, and all things considered, Morgan Spurlock was a good guest to have on at the time.
Fine gentleman.
Another
had we known.
Speaking of Me Too and speaking of sexual impropriety, another accuser has come forward against Sean Diddy Combs. This makes 8 lawsuits now, 7 active because he had settled with his ex-girlfriend Cassie. But he has been accused in a new lawsuit filed yesterday in New York by April Lampros, who says she met him in 1994 when she was a student at New York's Fashion Institute of Technology. And she says that on 4 instances, Diddy sexually assaulted her from the mid-90s to the early 2000s. The first was in 95 when he pressured her to drink at a New York bar, then took her to a hotel where she was laid on the bed and he forced himself on top of her. And then when she woke up, she was nude, sore, and confused.
That's the name of my new band.
How many times have you experienced that, Corby?
Me, personally, like, oh, whoa.
Nude, sore, and confused.
God, I'm so sore. Where am I?
And I'm confused.
Who did this to me?
Again.
How do I keep ending up like this?
She says in another incident, they were in a parking garage near his apartment in Manhattan when he, again, did the head push.
Is he drugging? Because drugs were involved in a lot of these stories.
Yeah, I think in that first one, she was drugged.
God.
But this one,
okay,
they were just in his car, and he did the head push, and he forced her to perform while a parking attendant was watching.
If he would have just if he would have just gone to the bar or restaurant with her, and they had a couple glasses of wine, and then he's like, hey, do you want to go back to my place? And you want to watch whatever? And then odds are...
Would you like to sign this consent form?
But what I'm saying
NDA?
Is, you know what I mean, though? Like, if he just would have had a date, odds are, because of who he is...
Yeah, he wants to take the shortcut. He wants the sure thing. Then in 96, she says that he forced her and one of his other girlfriends to take ecstasy at his apartment, and he demanded that the two of them have sex, and she denied that. And so then he said, well, I can make you lose your job. Then he fondled himself and then forced himself on her.
Doesn't seem like a normal guy.
No. And she said most recently she found out that he had recorded her without her consent and that he had shown those recordings to multiple people.
Yeah.
He's going to have a tough time coming back from this one.
Yeah, I don't think there's a path of redemption for Diddy.
When did you guys have him on?
We have not had Diddy on.
Yeah, when did you go to the white party?
He did not pick games with us. With Susan the ticket chick.
On the opposite
the big dog.
Yeah, the big dog.
On the opposite end of the morality spectrum, we have Harrison Butker, who of course in his commencement speech at the Benedictine College, he got in trouble for his old school.
Yeah, he wants women to not do anything.
His old school opinions. And so someone has finally gotten fired over this.
Oh.
Not who you think it is. It is not Butker. It is not anyone related to the Chiefs. It is the staffer who tweeted, just a reminder, Harrison Butker lives in the city of Lee's Summit. Staffer with the city of Kansas City.
Yeah.
So the mayor of Kansas City, Quentin Lucas, revealed that the city has, quote, separated from the staffer that posted that roast tweet.
So somebody had this staffer had control of the Kansas City Twitter account.
Yeah, just like the ticket account, many people have that login.
Yes.
And so at some this staffer put that out there. It was deleted shortly after, and then they tweeted an apology. We apologize for our previous tweet. It was shared in error. But that staffer has been fired, and the Missouri Attorney General was very angry because they believe that it put Harrison's safety at risk, telling people the city that he lives in.
Yeah. But I did see both Mahomes and Kelce come to his defense. Travis Kelce, I don't know if you had that, but Travis Kelce basically said, he goes, look, I really don't agree with one thing that he said.
Yes.
But he's a great guy.
Yeah, so this was on today's episode of the New Heights podcast, his smash hit podcast with his brother. And so, yes, Travis Kelce said that Harrison Butker is a great person who's entitled to his views, but he didn't agree with just about all of it except for the fact that he loves his family and kids.
Yeah, so basically none of it.
Yeah, so he said, you put your differences aside for a common goal. That's the beauty of team sports. So he's taking
end
around.
There's no athlete that cares about what Harrison Butker says except, how am I going to answer questions about Harrison?
Right,
Butker?
That's it.
Right, they did not.
But that does bother them.
Oh, yeah. They like, don't want to. Yes,
they're not,
that part bothers
they
them.
They were not happy. I know that. We know that. The team was not thrilled by what was said.
Right. I mean,
despite.
Let's just,
if I
keep
may,
those opinions to yourself.
Despite
or
the
maybe
fact that,
do it in a less public forum.
Yeah.
All true. I do think it probably should be said, though, that most professional athletes don't really want their wife working.
Yeah, but it's not. But they.
Not that they're against it.
Right.
They just want.
If they weren't professional athletes, they surely would, though.
Well, but they are professional athletes.
Yeah.
So I'm just saying, as the world freaks out about what the Chiefs kicker said, and yes, I can definitely see how it's an affront on many levels, the professional athletes don't care, except they are being inconvenienced by having to answer questions about him.
Yeah.
They did not mention Butker referring to Taylor Swift as his teammate's girlfriend. They glossed over that. Jason Kelce said that his wife, Kylie Kelce, was frustrated with what Butker said, but then Jason Kelce said he told her to go back in the kitchen and make him a sandwich.
Uh-huh. Yep. See?
I can't believe a football player would ever say something like that.
A couple more real quick. We have some audio here on a Friday. You know, Fridays are new music Fridays. Mm-hmm. And
if
so we talked.
Longer than 25 seconds, I'm going to blow my head off, but go ahead.
Okay, thank you. we had the story recently that Sublime had reunited at Coachella with late frontman Bradney Nowell's son, Jacob, as the current frontman.
Yeah.
Well, they have released their first new song in 28 years.
With the boy singing?
Well, it features a sample of Bradley from a jam session in 1996 that took place at Willie Nelson's studio in Austin. And his son. So his son does the verses, and then dad, the sample of the dad, is the hook. So see what you think. So that's the son.
Yeah.
Do the show, show your love for the people when they come, when they go. Meet your next generation and the next episode. Call me on the telephone, ask me if I'm. That sounds like Sublime.
It does. Yeah.
I mean, what are you going to do?
Sounds good. Sounds good. Did you ever see them?
Never did.
I didn't either.
I mean, it wasn't my alley.
Yeah, but I still would have liked to have seen that, because it was really interesting what they were doing at the time.
Yeah, and there were a number of bands at that time, like G-Love and Special Sauce, that
yeah.
were
stupid.
Kind of that were kind of, yeah, that were doing kind of an indie and reggae,
right,
reggaeton hybrid. Anyways, last thing. So we know that this is Pat Sajak's final season on the Wheel of Fortune.
God.
His last episode will be Friday, June 7th, but I don't know if he's going to top this in the meantime.
He won't.
As they had a puzzle in yesterday's show in the phrase category, and the correct answer is, this is the best. That is the correct phrase, but that is not what...
Well, okay, so have you seen the puzzle, actually, what he could see, the contestant saw?
Yeah, so it is a four-letter word, all blank, then letter I, blank, then blank, blank, E, then the last word was blank, 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 T, exclamation point.
Yes.
Okay, so the correct answer is, this is the best, but this is the incorrect guess.
Tavares, right in the butt.
What?
No.
No.
Blake.
This is...
Do you want to hear it one more time?
Yeah.
Tavares, right in the butt.
What?
What?
No.
And the best part is the look this guy gives.
Blake.
This is the best.
Yeah, that's it.
The look he gave, though, when he realized what he had said was like, oh, no.
And there's not even enough letters for right.
No. No, it was a full...
Right in the butt.
Full panic move by that man.
Yeah.
The aghast lady is funny.
What? That is your Friday E-News.
All right, good stuff. About 6 weeks ago, I started a text thread with one DJ Ringenberg and one Matt Birmingham. And it was simple.
Oh, no.
I said, hey, fellas, why don't we start marking every time Dave makes a sexual reference?
Come on.
Chopping wood.
Inside the butt home run.
I was whittling a dildo.
Blood anus.
Fist post.
And
what does raw mean?
All right.
What am I here for?
Just hold on.
All right, you know what? I'm never going to do it again.
That's a lie.
You can't resist it. And so we thought it may take 6 months or so to compile a segment. It took about 3 days.
It was unbelievable how quickly they started to rack up to the point where... I had to start whittling it down because there were so many good ones that they made the weak ones just not good enough.
We're not saying this is a bad thing.
We had a true bingo card happening.
Yeah. I mean, I feel a little bit judged. I'm not going
to
lie.
Well, don't, because I think you'll find this to be very amusing. So in a very short period of time, maybe since the beginning of baseball season, here...
Not even. This is May 1st.
Oh, my
we've
God.
We've done it May 1st here, so about 3 weeks of shows we've compiled this.
Here is sexual reference Dave. Here today on this May the 1st, Dave, seems like it was August yesterday, doesn't it?
May the 1st be with you.
May the 1st always be with you as well.
Or is it May the 5th be with you?
I think you
That's
know.
That's coming up on Saturday. May the 5th be with you.
I wonder, does LeBron really sleep more than 12 hours a day?
Man, I think they do.
Does Federer do that? That sounds incredible.
I wonder, like, if they're ever not quite tired enough for nap time, if they have to kind of stroke themselves to sleep.
That's what you're wondering?
Bringing it back to sex. The Chainsmokers.
Yeah.
You know, they used to talk about how they would tag team chicks in their hotel rooms when they first hit it big.
Wow.
Yeah, Bob.
They were living the dream.
My wife would have a problem with that, too.
Tag team and chicks.
The pegs go deeper now than they used to.
He's trying.
I did it.
I'm reading here that the length, Dave, of the pegs has alternated over the years.
a Beavis moment.
Originally 1 5/8 inches, but in 2002 the league increased them to 1 7/8 inches. So yeah, I guess another quarter inch or so. Oh. But can become less effective if they are not sitting at the correct depth. This provides a possible explanation for why some goalies will go weeks without dislodging a net once, then have it happen multiple times in a single game.
What if the NHL makes the actual holes look like a butt?
Corby?
What?
Like it's got
You're
a little,
not helping,
it's got
Dave.
A little bit of cleavage to it, like a little
Dave's,
mound.
Dave's trying super hard over there, and then...
And if it comes off, then the ref has to put his pants down at his ankles and bore it out.
Why do you have to put his pants around his ankles?
Dave is immediately buying season tickets if they make this change.
Oh, my God, yes. He'll do anything to sit behind the
goal. I'm going to sit next to the hashtag bang guy.
Right. Or you know what?
Hashtag peg.
If a cat is in your house or a dog is in your house for an extended period of time, your allergies will go away to that specific animal.
I don't believe you.
You tell your kids that, though.
So my
Papa's allergic to p***y.
No. Just no.
I mean, maybe they'll just put everyone in one section on one side.
Just piled in one triangle. Don't you agree?
Or one landing strip.
Yeah.
As it were.
Yeah. What is a powder bath anyway?
It's a half bath.
It's a half bath. Yeah. It doesn't have a shower tub.
There's no shower. There's just a... Okay. Bombing target.
It's a place. It's a place to powder your nose and powder your anus.
I had bad vibes about Richard Gere after seeing Officer and a Gentleman. Mainly by the way he would make out in love scenes.
I've heard you mention this before.
Yeah. Like too aggressive or what?
Yeah, just I guess got really bad vibes.
Does he have to, when he's making out with an actress on screen, does he have to pretend it's a gerbil?
The gerbil story wasn't even out yet. You don't.
It wasn't out?
I don't fully understand it.
Make out with a gerbil.
Well,
you don't need foreplay.
Yeah, kind of tickling their tummy. God. What are you doing? He was the first black performer to win for Best Supporting Actor in 1983. The third at the time to win, period. Hattie McDaniel and Sidney Poitier won.
Dad,
for
what's skull effing?
The It Girl, Sidney Sweeney. She has set her next project.
Did you say the It Girl or the...
It.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just. There was no CL before
Whoa,
that.
Jeez. He was using a different word.
I was doing Dave. Some comedy. You were doing something offensive.
Canadian League It Girl. Go ahead, Dave.
Thank you for that.
Yes.
Noir will tell the story of an aging and down on his luck private investigator, Private Dick, as they're called.
Yep.
Brittany Griner has released a book, and is a May 7th drop of a book called Coming Home.
Whoa. All I can think about is which two trophies would look the best going into each other.
Yeah, you're trying to fit them together like a little Jenga piece.
Uh-huh.
No, he's not.
The Larry O'Brien could definitely go into the top of the Stanley Cup.
Theoretically,
the Lombardi trophy could definitely go into the World Series trophy.
Like we never had to leave middle school.
Yeah, well, I mean, we learned this driving in the pastures of Wisconsin, and all he can see are peens.
The silos look like dong families. By the way, Richard Hatch, when he attended George Mason University, he donated sperm hundreds of times at a sperm bank in Fairfax, Virginia.
Well, that's a fun fact that I never thought I would know.
Don't let this happen, bro.
No.
I don't want to deal with this.
All right, Dave, let's do community quick hits.
It's so wet, baby. The typical year-to-date amount by this time in mid-May is 13.95 inches.
Let's go.
So like 6 more inches, if you know what I'm saying.
Let's get this thing going.
6 more inches to make it the 6th wettest.
Yeah. What a story for you, Dave.
One girl, Carla, said she met him at one of his shows in 1991 when she was 15, and he got her number, and he would call her late at night.
15!
And he would send her gifts and tickets to her shows, and then when she turned 18, he banged her. It was her first time, so she's...
Was that a quote,
I don't
Dave?
Feel like that. No, like well, that was my embellishment.
I heard things were done. I never did it myself,
Norm and Mary.
But I heard Norm and Mary would definitely hook up in the Spelunker's cave.
Right. Check the dipstick.
Right.
That's great.
Skeens, no, no.
In 2015, a gun.
For real?
Yeah.
All right.
11 punch-outs.
I'll be right back.
He gets to soak for a minute for every strikeout. That's what Olivia Dunn told him.
You're absolutely right. And she blows through guys like potato chips, man.
So to speak.
Like potato chips.
No knock on potato chips.
Or blowing.
If you will.
Okay. You can obviously do the go to dinner and
Honey
record
Bunny,
it.
Yes.
Watch over her shoulder.
Let's go to dinner and then I will, I'm sorry, what?
Watch over her shoulder. Like position her in the booth. To where you can look like you're making eye contact with her, but there's a flat screen right over her shoulder where you can watch the game.
Okay. Bob thought you made a sexual joke.
I thought you were talking about marital relations comedy.
Enjoy her in a canine fashion so you can both watch.
Jeez.
Dave.
There's nothing more masculine than a strong man supporting a strong woman.
There you go. Strong man supporting strong woman.
Yes. Yay! Every strong woman needs a strong man behind her.
You know, he's at that age where you get something technological or that's very vague, AirPods or something like that, you know. And
Fleshlight.
Yeah, Fleshlight for sure. To see what is on there. It's not because it's pornographic in nature, Ham.
This time,
as I love to look at porn on remote.
Show all your buddies.
Only the gayest porn.
Bro, have you seen this one? Corby, we're talking cowboys here. Oh, all right.
Have you ever seen a gape like that?
What? Wholesale BJs are coming to Texas.
Go on.
Okay.
Are you guys wholesale club members?
Yeah.
Costco.
I think we're Sam's. I went in there within the last month because my wife's back blew out.
You blew out on her back?
Do we need that?
You need your prostate?
The prostate?
Yeah.
Like if you massage it.
Is it a functioning thing where I need it to ward off like kangaroos
off,
or something?
It cuts spells. Off your tinkle stream, right?
I don't know.
It's like the O-ring that regulates your flow.
The O-ring. Okay.
And it's the O-ring when you get it tickled from behind.
Yeah.
You're pretty obsessed with that.
What?
You reference that three times a week.
What? Getting your prostate massaged?
Yes.
I do not.
I think you're pretty interested.
Riddled with hemorrhoids.
Am I?
Expects his prostate to be massaged.
Am I prostate massage curious? Yes, I am.
Okay. Inside the butt home run.
That's what I call it.
Now, DJ, as we listen to Sexual Reference Dave, how many options did you have to work with?
I mean, I left probably 15 things on the cutting room floor that we just didn't have time for.
It's like a Scorsese film, Dave.
Right, yeah. The director's cut is just way too long.
Yeah, it's coming out.
I mean, if we could do this at the end of every month, I'd love to keep track.
I'm just a sex trick pony.
This is like our May review.
Yeah,
and
it's our cars with karaoke or whatever bit. We just keep coming back to it.
I'm sorry. I apologize to everyone.
No.
Or are we all?
We owe you.
I apologize. I apologize to my wife, daughter, and mom.
What does June hold for us?
We'll never know. Well, we will know.
We will know soon enough.
Get the Steak podcast at patreon.com/sportsgreek.
Edmonton doesn't care who you played to get here. They think this is their destiny. This is their chance to finally win the cup. And when McDavid finally wins a cup, there's going to be citywide, nationwide.
That wasn't me.
I just I tried to say countrywide, and then I moved to nation, and I probably shouldn't have stopped right there. But the celebration will be insane. I don't know.
You.
I didn't mean to.
You just.
I've never said that word.
So the odds of me saying that word are very low, and everybody knows it was an honest misspeak. Me and Brad Sham.
Oh, wow. That was awesome. I've never said that word.
He's trying to be like Dave now.
I see it's working for Dave. Maybe this is a chance.
Get my own segment. Thank you to those fine people. Here is Dave.
Thank you. Well, let's get right to it. Tonight at the American Airlines Center, Diljit Dosanjh.
How?
Feel me, I'm the breeze, baby, on the ocean sky.
Okay, I wasn't expecting English.
I'm the forest in the trees, baby.
I don't know what I was expecting.
He comes in here in a second.
Oh. You know, we need to make a list of all the acts that have been through here in the last year.
At the American Airlines
Center?
Yes,
of how many Mex acts there are. And what?
Whoa. I don't think he's Mexican.
Yeah, he is dot, not feather.
Whoa.
How? Oh. Well, I apologize to the family then.
At the Granada War Paint.
So is he...
How?
He's at the AAC, though.
Yeah.
Yeah. How?
I mean, there are other cultures, Bob.
Thank you, Dave. I wasn't aware.
Bob.
At the Cambridge Room, Dead Poets Society.
But it's the American Airlines Center.
At the House of Blues, Chris Isaak. Didn't he do Fort Worth last week?
Chris Isaak?
Yeah.
Probably.
At Club Dada, Dan Deacon.
And then
at Southside Ballroom, Taking Back Sunday.
Your lipstick is colored up by the angel. I know exactly what goes on.
Oh. What early 2000s butt rock this sounds like.
At the Kessler, Sarah Geraz. At Toyota Music Factory, Gunna. At
Gunna.
Tulips Fort Worth.
Gunna what?
At Tulips Fort Worth, Death Ray Davies. At Billy Bob's, Lee Bryce. And at Greenville Municipal Auditorium tonight, Randy Travis. I thought he couldn't talk.
Yeah, they did an AI song.
Yeah, like the new song that we played evidently was put together with AI.
Yeah. Maybe they'll just put a MacBook up there, just hit play with a full band. And then, a cowboy hat on the MacBook.
And then he'll like Stephen Hawking the lyrics.
Right.
Like they hit space bar. And...
Yeah, they just go.
Tomorrow at Fair Park, the Togetherland Festival with Summer Walker, Key Glock, Gucci Mane, 3-6 Mafia, and more.
Does that mean computers in town?
I don't know.
No idea. At Sundown at Granada.
You text them.
I will.
Tomorrow and Sunday, Necromantics.
Lando.
At the House of Blues, Eddie Kenzo.
Hey!
Yeah, yeah.
Is this... What is this?
It's... It's...
Uh-oh.
I don't know.
Ugandan.
It's like the... Ugandan Pitbull. At Toyota Music Factory, the Exodus Music and Arts Fest featuring Kiera Sheard Kelly, Corin Hawthorne, and more. This is a Jesus thing, by the way. At Haltom Theater, Boundaries. At Tulips Fort Worth, Trophy Eyes. At Billy Bob, Shenandoah. And at Panther Island Pavilion, the Ooby Dooby Fest featuring R.L. Grime, Alice in Wonderland, and many, many more.
Is that a weed thing?
I don't know. It's. I think it's more like a DJ, like electronica type stuff. Sunday at Fair Park, day two of the Togetherland Festival with Lil Wayne, Lotto, and Jeezy, and many more.
And that's it. Panther Island?
No, that's at Fair Park.
Oh, God, it's going to be so hot there. All that concrete. Ugh.
Sunday at Granada, Sewin. At House of Blues, In Flames. Logan? You know In Flames?
Yeah, I never really got into them.
I saw them last year.
What is this? Oh, you did, Matt?
Yeah.
Where at?
The Factory.
And?
All right.
At Trees, Girlwood. At Double Wide, Black Tie Dynasty. At The Factory, Kubla Khan.
Wow. Son of Genghis Khan. Ooh.
Lando?
Kubla Khan TX.
I've never heard of this band before.
Whoa!
At Texas Trust CU Theater, Leo Dan.
Like, what three-word combo was that?
No, I think that was just a guitar riff.
Oh, I thought that was like a bleep.
No, I think that was just...
Oh.
That's the aesthetic.
At Toyota Music Factory, day two of Exodus Music and Arts Festival, featuring Anthony Brown, Da Truth, Kirk Franklin, and more. At Levitt Pavilion, Black Joe Lewis. At CBD Kratom Backyard, La Original Banda El Limon.
Do you know them, Bob?
I do not, no.
This is carnival music, for sure.
Like, what is this? Don't you picture, like, a donkey on stage playing the cymbals?
How would a donkey play cymbals? I'm interested. I just want to hear it.
Like, on his little hind legs, or maybe sitting on the couch. They have a little couch for him, and he's sitting there on his butt.
At Billy Bob's, Jake Worthington. At Panther Island Pavilion, Ooby Dooby Fest Day 2, featuring Sudden Death, Said the Sky, and more. Monday at Dos Equis Pavilion, makeup show, Neil Young and Crazy Horse.
Dave, canceled again.
Canceled again?
Somebody got sick in the band, and Neil Young has postponed for the second time.
Diary.
What in the world? Also Monday at House of Blues, Shally Poppy at Tannehill's Tavern, Taking Back Sunday, doing the Dallas-Fort Worth thing. Tuesday at House of Blues, Mariah the Scientist at Echo Lounge, Battle Beast at Southside Ballroom, Two Door Cinema Club.
Kind of fun.
Yeah.
By the way,
I enjoy them.
Is it Neil Young from Western Canada? Maybe Neil wants to watch Edmonton play.
Maybe that's why he canceled?
Let's see. If I get this right, Bob, you owe me money.
That's a weird bet.
Wednesday at the Echo Lounge, From Ashes to New, at the House of Blues, Thievery Corporation.
Yeah.
If you like drugs, you will like Thievery Corporation.
Yeah, yeah.
They moved to Omimi, Ontario, where he grew up. It's not Western Canada, is it?
No. Ontario is definitely not Western Canada.
At the Factory Microwave. I'm sorry, at the studio at the Factory Microwave. Well, at Southside Ballroom.
Johnson is playing.
Yes. Madison Beer at Southside Ballroom. At Tannehill's Tavern.
Maddie Beers!
Madison Beer.
I know, but that was my nickname for him, and it's already taken.
At Tannehill's Tavern, Tab Benoit or Benoit?
Benoit.
At Will Rogers Auditorium, Britt Floyd. Thursday at Dos Equis Pavilion, Hootie and the Blowfish with Collective Soul and more. At Sundown at Granada, Green Buddha. At House of Blues, Tizo Touchdown. At Southside Ballroom, T-Pain.
Yeah.
T-Pain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Young John.
Hey.
I don't think we have time to get to it, T-Pain.
I do enjoy, though, when people mention their own names in their songs. Can you imagine, like, a rock and roll song from the E Street Band where right out of the chute he's like, yeah, Bruce Springsteen.
Bad Company did it.
Bad Company did. I'll give you that.
Boy, Lando ready to fight you over that one.
Yeah, at Club
that
Dada,
was too aggressive. I apologize.
At Club Dada on Thursday, Azizi Gibson. At the Majestic, Natalia Jimenez. At Tulips Fort Worth, Contortion. And at Will Rogers Auditorium, Jeff and Sherry Easter.
In the name of Jesus,
Well, I don't know why I laughed.
Gay.
Just sounded funny. All right, Bob, I guess you have to go.
No, I don't. Yeah. I really don't.
Yeah, you're gonna,
and you have to take Sally.
What's Thursday? Is that a Mavs or a Stars night?
That would be Mavs. Yeah. Yeah, you're going to have to miss the Mavs.
Miss Mavs game four.
To go see Jerry and Sherry Jesus.
I don't think that's how...
Their name is Jeff and Sherry Easter. Oh. I mean, it's almost
Oh,
Jeff
my
and
God,
Sherry
are you
Jesus.
Kidding me?
That's a stage name.
So, yeah, like, if your last name was Christmas, you have to get into that world.
Produce the ID, or I'm not believing your last name.
Yeah, let's see the long-form birth certificate, Jeff Easter.
God.
And at the Reconsider Lounge.
Okay.
A Billy Squire tribute fronted by Deddy returning home from prom without a date but still horny. Sock Me Tonight. And a Simple Minds tribute fronted by Jubb, who keeps thinking someone who hasn't won in 8 years is still in contention. Don't You Forget About Spieth.
Oh, that's
poor
mean.
George.
Man, poor Jordan.
Man,
poor
yeah,
Daddy.
Jordan, too. And Daddy.
Poor Daddy.
Poor Sock.
Oh, yeah.
That's the biggest loser of the night.
Unintended loser, the Sock.
All right, rank those four.
Spieth, George, Dunham, Sock, for sure. All right, 6:50 on the ticket.